Okay, so good morning. My name is Trevor Shell, and I'd like to welcome you all to RSI Day 2016. This year is unique in the fact RSI Day is actually falling on the day it was created, which is February 29th. The founders of RSI Day created it to be the only non-repetitive day of a standard year. So once, if you look at it in quarters, once every 4 years, it's still repetitive, but not as much. I'd like to say a special greetings to any New Year's ba- or New Year's leap years ba- leap year babies, including my director, who turns 15 today. To start off with, I'd like to thank our sponsors, without who today would not be possible: the Canadian Union of Public Employees National, the Union of Taxation Employees Local 42, the Public Services Health and Safety Association, De Beers, Laurentian University, the Ontario Nurses Association, and the Canadian Union of Public Employees Ontario. Today, we're broadcasting out across the world to about five different countries, all across Canada, a few U.S. states. We're supposed to have 100 people here in the audience in Sudbury, but due to the weather and the roads, we don't have quite as many. And for those of us here in Sudbury, I'm sure we'd rather be joining some of those people online from California and Australia and Florida who are watching us right now as well. We have about 400 online who are partaking in today's event as well. Now, I'd like to introduce my Executive Director, Denis Boileau, who is going to say a few words.
Good day to everyone. My name is Denis Boileau, and as Trevor said, I am the Executive Director, and I'm actually looking at three clinics at OCAL, the one which is new, the newer one in Eastern Ontario, which is located in Ottawa. There is also the one here in Sudbury, and also the other one that I look at is the one in Thunder Bay. I would simply like to say thank you for coming, especially after the nice snow that we've had yesterday. And I hope that you have an enjoyable day. And if you have any questions or concerns, please feel free to contact us. And if you want to speak with me, I certainly will be going around and glad-handing to people everywhere. Bienvenue à tout le monde. Je vous remercie d'être ici aujourd'hui pour cette journée. Je suis le directeur général de OCAL pour trois différentes cliniques. Je suis le directeur pour la clinique de Sudbury, celle de Thunder Bay, et la nouvelle clinique qui est maintenant dans l'est de l'Ontario, qui est à Ottawa. Si vous avez des questions ou quoi que ce soit, soyez garant de venir nous demander et j'espère de vous rencontrer à la pause et d'échanger quelques mots avec chacun de vous. Merci beaucoup. Bonne journée. Have a great day. Thank you.
Thanks, Denis. And I'd now like to introduce David Chesie, the President and Chair of OCAL's Board of Directors, to say a few words as well.
Thank you, Trevor. Thank you, everyone, for showing up today in today's cold temperatures here in Sudbury, but others around the world and in other places in Canada, it's much warmer. But thank you all for coming. In my role as President and Chair of OCAL provincially is to do quite a few things, but today is one of the really warming things that I like to do, and that's to come out and say thank you to all of you here present, and to say thank you to the staff here at OCAL, that Sudbury Clinic, and all of the other clinics who you will see today through the ergonomists that have come to present to you. I want to say thank you on behalf of the board. Thank you to all of the participants online. I think by the agenda that you see here today, we're in for a real treat and some a real learning opportunity. So thank you again to Denis and Trevor and all of the staff in all of the clinics, and for everything that you do to help injured workers in the province of Ontario. Thank you and have a great day.
All right, so I'd like to introduce our first speakers. They are Dr. Tammy Eager and Mallory Leduc, PhD student from CROCH and Laurentian University.
So while they get our slides up, I'll just thank you for coming. I know the day was probably a challenge for everybody with the snow, but I'm glad everybody made it safely. CROSH stands for the Center for Research in Occupational Safety and Health, and we are a research center at Laurentian University, and we look at a number of health and safety issues facing workplaces in the north. So if you haven't heard about us, by all means, reach out at some point. We're involved with OCOW as one of our partner organizations, so we do a fair bit of work together. So Trevor, thank you for inviting us here today. Okay, so today I'm going to be talking to you about whole body vibration, hand-arm vibration, and foot-transmitted vibration, or basically all the types of vibration exposure that you may experience within the workplace. And Mallory and I are going to tag team, so when you'll get to hear a little bit from both of us. We'll cover the health risks, how you evaluate vibration, and then what are some of the prevention strategies. And hopefully you can each take some of those home and back into your own workplaces. So to start with, as I said, there's three different types of vibration that individuals could be exposed to. If we think about the typical lift truck, you get hand-arm exposure when you are in contact with the steering wheel, for example. You can also get hand-arm vibration exposure if you're operating drills or impact equipment, so your typical mechanics would have a lot of hand-arm vibration exposure. Whole body then is what we most typically experience when we're driving vehicles. So in this case, whole body's coming through the seat of that vehicle. Yourself, when you're driving through some of the rougher roads in Sudbury, you hit those potholes, that's whole body vibration you're experiencing. And then you can also get vibration through the feet, foot transmitted vibration, the pedals of these types of vehicles, but also in the mining industry in particular, when you're standing on platforms or vehicles, jumbo drills, things like that will vibrate and put vibration through your feet. When we're looking at trying to understand the health effects, there's four factors that become really important. So the first is the magnitude, and that's really, if you like, sort of the size of the bounce or the amplitude of the signal. So again, if you imagine you're driving over a really rough road and it's got a lot of potholes, and if you're driving at a fairly fast speed, you're going to get a high magnitude of vibration. So that's the bounce height, if you like. Frequency then is sort of the cycles per second or the bounces per second. I'm going to talk more about that. We need to know the duration of exposure, and we need to know the direction. So you can be exposed to vibration in the vertical direction. You can get fore aft, side to side, and those become important as well. The reason frequency is so important is people will often ask this. It's like, well, when I'm exposed to or operating this piece of equipment, I have more problems with my hands. But when I'm operating this piece of equipment, my back hurts. And the reason being is that the frequency makes a big difference. So there's different body regions that are more affected by vibration at different frequencies. So, for example, if any of you have operated a whippersnipper in the summer, you're cutting your grass, that's a little bit of a higher frequency, typically 30 to 40 hertz, and that's why you get the tingling in the hands, so it affects your hands. Low back is more affected at lower frequencies, so 3 to 5 hertz, so that's the lower frequency you get when you're driving, typically on a road. And you can see that, the eyes, for example, if you're on a really rough road and if you're getting a 20 to 25 hertz signal, you may have problems with your eyes, with your head. So that's why sometimes people feel nauseous. Sometimes they have different regions of their body that will bother them. Okay, so now I'm going to turn it over to Mallory to talk a little bit more about health risks in particular. And we will have time for questions at the end, so by all means, keep those if you've got a few points.
Good morning, everyone. So I'm going to just go through the health risks here for you for looking at, again, whole body vibration, the foot transmitted, and the hand transmitted vibration, and what we can learn about each of them. And while still keeping in mind, as Tammy said, understanding how the different frequencies influence the body and how we can look out for this for ourselves or for the workers that we try to protect. So when we look at whole body vibration, again, this is when typically the workers are in a seated posture and the vibration, again, is coming up through the buttocks area. So most commonly we do see lower back pain, spinal degeneration, and neck problems. So we can see structural damage and other issues that influence the spinal column of the workers. Also, muscle fatigue and sleep problems, headaches, and gastrointestinal tract issues are other complaints of workers who are often seated in these postures and receiving vibration throughout the day. So again, this would be in the 1 to 20 hertz range, and as you would see, that would correspond back to what Tammy mentioned for the resonant frequency of the lower range for the back. And of more concern too is when we look at these workers when they're in a non-neutral posture. So when their neck is rotated or their trunk is rotated, these workers in either the mining industry or in agriculture, where they are either operating the vehicle going in one direction and have to look at the other, or where depending on where their load is, that we see that there is a higher risk for low back injury when you're combining both your vibration exposure and this non-neutral posture of operating the equipment. When we switch over to foot transmitted vibration, it is a relatively newer, less evidence, I should say, for documenting this. But there is a case report in 2010, which was the first one, and this documented a 54-year-old male who was in the mining industry for over 35 years, and specifically 18 years on the bolter. So he did, in their description of the work description, it was mainly vibration through the foot, and the way their controls were set up was relatively low through the hand. So he did experience pain, numbness in the toes and feet, and this is why the case report went forward. So you can see when they did do their plethysmography, you can see at the top that their hands, the waveform showing the blood flow in the hands was normal. But when you look at the foot, so before showing the normal waveforms, but after cold stress, you can see the decrease in blood circulation. You can see the dampening of the signal. When we switch over to hand-arm vibration, you can see that there are three different components when we look at the health risk for hand-arm vibration. So there's typically a vascular component, a neurological component, and a muscular component. So when we look at the vascular, this is affecting the circulatory system. So this is where you see the blanching and the decreased blood flow in the hands. When we look at the neurological, this is influencing the nerve. So this is where you're damaging the sensory to the hand and the fingers. So a worker would experience tingling and numbness in their fingers and hands, and would influence their dexterity, right? Because it's influencing the sensitivity of their fingers. Also musculoskeletal disorders here. So you can see that they would have a decrease in grip strength, and over time their manual dexterity and strength of their hands and fingers definitely goes down. Visually, when we look at the vascular component, as you can most often see, is the blanching of the fingers. So this may begin at the tips of the fingers and gradually, as it worsens, continue down one or more of the fingers. And now Tammy will discuss if we are identifying these health risks, how we can evaluate and measure them.
Thanks, Mallory. We're hoping by this tag team approach that you won't get tired of listening to either of us for too long, so we'll keep switching it around. So as Mallory said, we understand that there are health effects, but how do we know whether the workers or ourselves, if we're exposed to vibration, whether we're at risk? Well, there are some standards that exist that tell us how we should measure vibration in the workplace, and then there are some criterion values that we can use to indicate, are we above or below those values, and that gives us an indication of risk. There are a number of standards. The most common ones I've highlighted there in bold. So for whole body, it's the International Standard 2631-1. For hand arm, it's the International Standard 5349-1. If your company does work in Europe as well, there's a European Union directive. If that's the case, you can always give me a call after and I can give you some more information on that standard. But today I'm just going to talk about the two ISO standards. Now, within Ontario, it's important to note that there is no specific guideline. So what's used then, if you're concerned about vibration in the workplace, is the general duty clause. So although these international standards exist, it's not law in Ontario that your workers have to be exposed to values below that. But if you do feel that there is vibration issues, you can use this general duty clause to have an assessment performed. Okay, when we're looking at measuring whole body vibration then, typically what's used is a triaxial accelerometer, and that's placed typically within a seat pad, which is that rubber disc that you see there. That's then placed on the seat, usually secured with something as fancy as duct tape, just to keep it in place. And then you use a data logger or some type of a computer to collect the signal. So that's typically what's done. So you can see our fancy duct tape situation there. And again, you're measuring vibration in the vertical, the forward and back, and the side-to-side direction. Now, what's important when we look at the standard, how long do you need to measure for? You don't typically need to measure for an entire day, but you need to make sure you're measuring long enough that it's representative of the work that's being performed. So if you have a driver that's, for example, let's say if you're a city bus driver and you're driving the same route over and over, it would be typical that you might just measure for that driving route, and then you could extrapolate to what your 8-hour exposure would be. But if you have somebody that's driving in different areas over different terrain and their task is quite variable throughout the day, you would really need to measure all of those sections of their job to get a representative sample. Okay. Then what's happened is the values are compared to what's called the health guidance caution zone, and there's values that for an 8-hour day that we want to be below, okay? And what those values are shown here. So according to the standard, if you're looking at an A8 value is called your frequency-weighted RMS acceleration. I'm not going to go into the math behind what the frequency weighting is. The standard tells you how to do that frequency weighting, and most of your measurement equipment will do it appropriately. If you have specific measurement questions after, you can always get a hold of me and I can try to go through those. But what we know is if you are exposed to vibration above a 0.9, it means that health risks are likely. So that's an 8-hour equivalent frequency weighted RMS acceleration, which is your A8 value. A VDV is called a vibration dose value. That value is used if you have a lot more potential impacts or very rough road conditions where you're going to have a lot more variability in your signal. And it's just another value that you can use to compare. Okay. So here's an example from a typical load haul dump vehicle in mining, and what you see then is the A8 value on the vertical axis. So again, that's your 8-hour equivalent frequency weighted RMS acceleration plotted against that health guidance caution zone. So green's below, yellow's within, and red is above. And you can see for many of the samples when we've taken over the years for load haul dump vehicles would indicate that those operators are typically exposed either within the guidance caution zone or above, which would tell us that health risks for things like that Mallory talked about, like low back pain, neck problems, gastrointestinal tract problems are likely. Okay. Now, having said that, I just told you you need some fancy equipment to measure whole body vibration. Researchers out of the University of Australia and folks from our lab have been working together, and we've actually validated an application that you can download for free, and you can use your iPhone or your iPod as a vibration measurement machine. So the accelerometers have gotten actually good enough in those devices that you can use it as an initial screening for whole body vibration. So there's the link there for more information if you want to try measuring your own exposure on some of the Sudbury roads. You'll be surprised. I think you'll see you're in the yellow, and you know. So having said that, our bus drivers, our taxi drivers are actually exposed to levels that could put them at some increased risk for low back problems. Okay, but what if you don't have access to measure anything directly? Well, there are published data sources that exist, and if you know something about the type of equipment you're using, you can use those published data sources to try to, again, estimate what your exposure is. Okay, so things that are important, the type of equipment, the class of equipment, if it has any suspension features that might attenuate vibration, operating speed becomes really important, and understanding the surface that you're operating on. But so, for example, this chart here is from the EU Good Practice Guide to Whole Body Vibration. And what you're seeing there in the orange is basically saying from all the published data that we have, we're going to sort of give you the 25th to the 75th percentile for what exposure has been reported for those vehicles. So it gives you a kind of a range, and you can see it's quite variable. If we were to look at the asphalt paver, I mean, the lowest value was about a 0.1, and the highest value is off the charts at 2 meters per second squared. Big difference. So it does show you that there's lots of variability, and that has to do with the speed, the road conditions, the maintenance of the vehicle. But if you don't have any way of measuring, at least you have a rough idea of where your exposures might be. There's also a database. If you're able to work in French, there's a nice database out of one of the French Health and Safety Associations. It allows you to pick the type of vehicle, and it'll give you an estimation of what your A8 exposure would be if you put in the duration. So it's a handy database for some individuals. Okay, so that's basically a quick overview of whole body vibration measurement. And again, you use your health guidance caution zone in terms of trying to understand exposure and risk. And I'm gonna turn it over to Mallory now, and she's gonna tell you a little bit about measuring foot transmitted and hand transmitted vibration.
All right, so when we look at foot transmitted vibration, as I mentioned before with the initial case study only coming out in 2010, the standards for how we or how it's regulated on how what the proper procedures are for measuring it and reporting it aren't as clear-cut as they are for whole body vibration and hand arm vibration. So we could I'll present a few of the results that I had actually from my master's thesis that that'll bring out how there's still confusion on which standard would be best or potentially a new standard for foot transmitted vibration. So when we did take some foot transmitted vibration measurements from a raised worker, these were both on metal raised and wooden platforms, we saw that 100% of the workers that we measured did have a report that they had hand-arm vibration syndrome, and actually 75% did have vibration-induced white foot. So they were experiencing pain, discomfort, and the vascular, neurological, muscular, problems in their foot, sorry. So when we look at the raised workers, they were the ones that were exposed to the greatest magnitude of vibration. So we looked at other workers that were operating locomotive jumbos, and the raised workers were the most concerning going forward. And they had a dominant exposure of 40 hertz. So when we look at how this is related to the dominant frequency, this is more in line with what we would see for hand-arm vibration syndrome. But when we look at other pieces of equipment that we did measure from the locomotive, they were a lot lower. So they were more in the dominant frequency 3 to 6 range, which would be more congruent with whole body vibration. And when this came out, when we asked the workers to report where they were experiencing discomfort, where they were experiencing pain, you could see the dominant frequency less than 6. It was more of systemic, so that the workers were reported experiencing discomfort throughout their whole body, neck, back, knees, and legs. So these would be the operators that were operating the locomotives. So experiencing a lower dominant frequency, but still in a standing posture. When we looked at the jumbo drill, the bolters, and the raise, you can see the pain, discomfort, and the symptoms surrounding the hand and feet. Also, there is, all over, but they also did have diagnosed cases of hand-arm vibration syndrome, which would lead us to think that perhaps just measuring it with the whole body standard may not be the best approach, and that potentially when you take your measurements to take into consideration the hand-arm vibration standard as well. So when we look at hand-arm vibration, there is the international standard, so as Tammy mentioned, the ISO 5349. So again, not to go into too much of it, but this is where you want to go if you are planning on taking measurements in your workplace. So again, you would follow these guidelines. They're standardized as to how you would go through and collect these measurements in order to make sure that they are comparable and reproducible in comparison to other tools. So again, as Tammy mentioned, securing the accelerometer is always important, and I'll get to that in a few minutes, but also again, the sufficient duration. So you want to make sure that your samples that you're taking are comparable to the work exposure that your workers are actually receiving. And again, that you're operating it under conditions that are regular to their operating procedures is always best case scenario. So that if you're actually taking the measurements while they're working on the regular set of equipment under the normal environmental conditions, that sort of thing, under the same sort of stress that they may be under, is definitely ideal. So again, here's just a picture of the triaxial accelerometer, so you can get smaller ones to do the hand-arm vibration measurements so that doesn't impair the hands of the worker while they're doing it. Again, the standard goes through the specific attachment points, so they have specific guidelines as to where you attach the accelerometer for the different types of equipment that may be out there and the different types of handling that the worker will and coupling that the worker will have with the tool. Again, duration is important. So also when you're considering hand-arm vibration, you need to look at whether it's continuous exposure or intermittent exposure, and trigger time is the important thing. So you need to document while you are taking your measurements how long the worker is actually holding on to the piece of equipment. So whether you're saying that they're operating a chainsaw for, you know, 1 hour, 2 hours, that sort of thing, but how long are they actually handling the chainsaw with it running as opposed to picking it up, putting it down, that sort of thing. So that's really important to get an understanding of how long the worker is being exposed and how long the vibration is coming in through the hand arm system. Again, not to bore you with too much math, but they are collecting it in the X, Y, and Z axis, and then through the math, we come up with a vibration total value, and less than 2 meters per second squared would be, symptoms would be rare, and then above that, we would expect to see symptoms from our workers. Again, this is from, as Tammy showed, for whole body vibration. Here's for hand arm vibration. So you can see the vibration total value of 2 meters per second squared in the red line. And you can see that the majority of the common tools that could be used are above this, suggesting that workers who are operating this may be experiencing symptoms and having health impacts as a result of this. So again, you can see the range of what the values could potentially be for all the document exposures of them. That's why it is important for workplaces to have the vibration measured to see how what the worker actually is being exposed to, rather than always when you rely on the recorded data that there is such a range. So it could vary a lot. There also are, again, online tools, so you can go on the website here, and if you know your vibration total value, you can enter it in, and then it will tell you what the daily exposure is for that tool and give you the time guidelines. Some tool manufacturers are also coming out with their own exposure calculators. So here you can, again, if you know the vibration value input, you're able to calculate what the exposure duration is on there. So a few other resources for you to take a look at if you're interested more. All right, so Tammy's going to look at now when we understand the health risks and how we're measuring it, what can we do about it?
Okay, so far, as Mallory said, we've talked about the types of vibration you can be exposed to. We've talked about how you could measure, and we've talked a little bit about the criterion values that might indicate whether you're at risk. But if you do find that you're exposed to vibration in the workplace that may put you at risk for one of those health effects, how can we look at trying to control those risks? So I'll start with some control strategies for whole body vibration. Okay, you guys are all health and safety folks in this room, or I'm sure have been to a number of different talks before, so I'm sure you're quite familiar with the hierarchy of controls. So vibration as a hazard is no different. We try to use the hierarchy of controls when looking at the best control strategy. So elimination is always ideal, but in many cases it's not practical. So if you can, though, eliminate somebody from exposure to vibration, then that's where you start. If you can find something where you can substitute, that's your next step. But in many cases, we're dealing with what are the engineering solutions, what are the administrative solutions, and are there any types of personal protective equipment? So that's where we'll talk a little bit. So again, some of the just general strategies you can use, as I said, you can remove the worker from the vibration source if at all possible. And in some cases that happens. There is some movement in some industries where equipment's now being operated from a teleremote station, so the worker's not physically on the equipment the entire time that it's operating, so that removes some of their exposure. Purchasing equipment with lower vibration emissions or exposure. That's really, really critical, and in many cases, individuals that are in charge of making purchasing decisions within the workplace aren't necessarily aware that vibration is a factor, and they don't ask the manufacturers of those pieces of equipment what are the vibration emission values. So if you do have the ability to make purchasing decisions, it's really important that you ask those equipment manufacturers. If you're looking at buying a new bus, for example, for urban city driving, or if you're looking at buying a new piece of mobile equipment for mining or construction, you can ask the equipment manufacturer, have you done any assessments? What is the vibration exposure at the operator's level? What type of suspension is in that vehicle? Are there special seats that have been put in to help to reduce the exposure to the operator? So that's really, really critical. If you can start to have that process implemented, it's going to make a big difference. I'm going to talk about road maintenance in a little bit, and driving speed and some of these other factors as I move forward. Okay, so this was a particular study. So our research team worked with a mining equipment manufacturer, and we really did want to show once and for all that lower driving speeds make a significant difference in reducing an operator's exposure to vibrations. So what you see here is on the vertical is the frequency weighted, again, root mean squared acceleration. The higher that value, the greater the risk for injury for the operator. And at the bottom, you see we have gear one, gear two, gear three, and what's called auto shift or gear four. Really what we want to get to the point is the faster you drive, the more vibration exposure you will experience. So we're not suggesting that everyone's going to be able to operate in gear one, but what we are suggesting is within, again, the design of work, that there's realistic operating speeds put in place for the type of production that is expected. So you can't, on one hand, tell the workers drive slower, but then bump up their production expectations. There has to be a real understanding of how much work can actually get done in a time frame that can allow them to operate at a speed that is both safe, but also will help to reduce their exposure. So driving speed makes a difference. It also makes a difference whether those vehicles are loaded or unloaded. So again, another example from this particular mining vehicle. So this would be important for dump truck operators. Anyone that's operating a large piece of equipment, when it's not loaded, when it doesn't have that extra mass in it, it's going to vibrate more. So again, you want to think about potentially having lower speeds when that vehicle is empty. And in many cases, what we see is when the vehicle's empty, it's driving even faster. Right, and the problem is now that operator is getting exposed to even more vibration. So again, you can see the difference between the loaded bucket versus the empty bucket. And you think, well, maybe that's not that much, but we're looking at a magnitude of about 1.9 in fourth gear empty versus a magnitude of about 1.25, 1.3 when it's loaded. So remember, when we looked at the health guidance caution zone, anything above 0.9 puts you at an increased risk for injury. So, we really do need to consider the load of the vehicle as well. Road conditions make a big difference. I mean, you've all driven on roads that have been newly paved versus roads that have lots of potholes. It's the same for our industrial equipment operators. If you're driving on a road that's had a grader go over it recently, has realistic road maintenance conditions versus something that has got a lot of potholes, broken muck or rock, it makes a big difference. So in here, what you're seeing is the red is the vibration exposure for the same speed on an unmaintained road, and blue is for the maintained road. So road maintenance makes a big difference. And again, even within a city environment, if you're a taxi driver, an urban bus driver, you'll understand where those rough roads are and how challenging that can be. So again, making sure your workplace has a comprehensive road maintenance program is really important. Seats. Okay, I'm gonna spend a little bit more time. I think I have time still, Mal, so I'm gonna talk about seats a little bit longer. Seats make a big difference. The tricky thing is you can't pick the ideal seat for your particular vehicle just because it looks pretty and it has the word ergonomic on it. And that's a challenge, I realize, for many individuals, because even the manufacturers may give you the indication that that seat is suited for the vehicle that you want to put it in within the environment in which it's going to operate. But unless they've specifically tested it in that environment, you won't know for sure whether that's the best seat. I give this example. So what you see here on this this figure again is your frequency weighted RMS acceleration is on the vertical, and the exposure, vibration exposure measured at the seat is shown in blue, and the exposure we measured below the seat is shown in red. And it's hard for you to probably see on this image, but trust me, the blue is higher than the red. So what that means is this seat here is actually amplifying the vibration and exposing the worker to more vibration. Said another way, this worker would be better to be sitting on a rigid metal seat than this particular seat. So just think about that for a second. It may be labeled ergonomic. In fact, it was. This was a new seat this company was trying out. It had all the fancy ergonomic features. You could adjust the lumbar support, move it up and down. It looked really pretty. It was well labeled. But from a perspective of being able to deal with vibration, it didn't have the right suspension mechanisms within it to deal with the type of exposure. Okay, remember way back early on, I talked to you about resonant frequency, how each region of the body responds differently to a certain type of frequency. Well, the vehicle seats have a natural frequency or resonance as well. So there's a certain frequency at which that seat will maximally vibrate and will amplify a signal that goes through it. So it's really important that we understand the type of vibration we're exposed to so that the proper seat can be selected for the conditions in which that worker is going to be operating. Said another way, there's a research team out of the UK who looked at 100 different seats from 14 different vehicles. And this should shock everybody. 94% of the vehicles evaluated would have had better vibration attenuation if a seat from one of the other vehicles tested in the study was in that vehicle versus the one that was actually originally installed by the manufacturer. 94%. Okay, so again, seat selection can be challenging, but it's really important. So what our research team did, we worked with the mining and forestry and construction industry, and we took 30 of the most common vibration profiles that we had collected over the years from those three industries, and we looked at evaluating the performance of five commercially available seats. And how we did that is what you're seeing here is sort of a robotic motion platform. So when we collect the vibration information in the field, we can feed this into this robotic platform and it replicates it. So we could say, okay, replicate the profile for an urban bus, replicate the profile for a skidder, for a load haul dump vehicle operator, that sort of thing. And it'll shake the person up. It's a really good ride. Normally you'd pay a lot of money for that at the midway, right? But we have our participants come in here and experience this for as part of our study. Okay, so then what you get is what's called a SIET value, which is a ratio of the vibration that you measure at the floor to the vibration at the seat. And you want that value to be less than 1 or less than 100. That would tell us that the seat was attenuating the vibration and not amplifying it. Okay, so here this graph is going to be a little bit tricky, but the SIET values on the vertical. So where you see the 1, I apologize, there's no laser pointer, but about midway up the graph, you see a 1. And really only about a quarter of those signals are below 1. So this tells us the majority of those seats in most of the circumstances amplified the vibration. The only seat that actually performed really well was the seat that's shown with the green triangle, and that was one that was manufactured by CAT in this particular circumstance. So what this tells us, if they were being exposed to the vibration signals that were more similar to between 2 to 3 in terms of the magnitude and the frequency associated with the signals that we were putting in from construction, forestry, and mining, that seat would perform the best. But you can see in other circumstances, there were other seats that performed better. So again, you have to understand the type of vehicle that you're testing. So we were able to identify the seat that would be best for that particular industry. Okay, so that was sort of an overview of whole body vibration, and Mal's gonna come up and talk about foot transmitted vibration and hand arm controls.
Okay, so when we, again, switching back to foot transmitted hand arm vibration, again, removing the worker from the vibration source may not always be applicable for every workplace. So we want to look at, again, purchasing equipment, as Tammy mentioned, and I'll show some data that supports that as well. Again, the maintenance of the equipment is same as whole body when with maintenance of any of your vehicles and that sort of thing. And again, isolated platforms for workers to stand on, so I'll get into that as well. So here for looking at hand arm vibration reduction with a drill with an anti-vibration different type of handle. So you can see here that the conventional handle had accelerations of above 20, And then with this anti-vibration handle that was engineered specifically for the rock drill, you can see that it brought it down quite significantly. So if we can, as industry and health and safety professionals, continue to demand that the engineering and that the tool manufacturers consider vibration as a hazard and work to identify solutions that we can actually reduce these values quite significantly. When we look at an example from foot transmitted vibration, this is from a jack leg being operated on a metal raise. And here we took measurements using the typical jack leg, again on the metal raise, and then you can see the one that's lowered in yellow is the jack leg using an anti-vibration leg attachment instead of the typical one. So you can see that the vibration levels were reduced from above the health guidance caution zone down to within the health guidance caution zone. So here even, not that it's simple, but a modification to the engineering of how the tool and how the jack leg is operated significantly reduced the vibration levels that the worker was experiencing from the jack leg coming up through their feet. Here again, we looked at measurements on a jumbo platform, and we took measurements on the jumbo that did not have the isolated platform, and then again on ones that had a specifically engineered platform where the worker would stand. So although the worker didn't always specifically stand in this area, it did have a significant reduction again on the vibration. You can see that through their engineering, they are able to dampen the vibration in that specific location. So if the worker is operating the controls in that area, you can see from the graph where the solid platform is in blue and then the isolated platform, the engineering design, is in red. So you can see the reduction in vibration. So again, without eliminating the vibration, the worker still has to perform their job duties, but for engineering solutions like this are really the way to reduce vibration the most. So again, if we can continue to make that a priority in purchasing decisions and have companies provide a reduction in vibration emissions for their products is definitely the way to protect the workers the best case scenario. Again, for the tools for hand arm, is maintenance is very important and replacement programs. So again, we want to make sure that the workers are replacing any work tools that are not performing well, so that keep them sharp, and replacing any damaged tools will definitely impact the vibration that the workers that is experiencing. So whether or not they're gripping harder because it's not as sharp, or you know, having to lean in, and then that will cause other issues as well. So again, when we look at PPE, although not when we think back to the hierarchy of controls, definitely on the bottom, but there are anti-vibration gloves that, although the research is still mixed out there on how effective they are, so there are positives where they keep the hands dry and warm, and the certified ones will reduce vibration levels above 200 hertz, and if they are certified again, will not amplify the lower frequencies. But again, they can also increase the grip that the worker is holding and increase fatigue. So sometimes it again, engineering is the way to go. But there are positives to the anti-vibration gloves. And when we did look at how we can implement these and look at this as a method of safety behavior. So just to talk a little bit about intervention that was conducted, I came in to this project on the tail end of it, but a team of researchers from the Center for Research in Occupational Disease created a one-page double-sided laminated document for hand-arm vibration syndrome for the construction industry. So they wanted to see if they could disseminate information about hand-arm vibration syndrome through the occupational health clinic as opposed to through the workplace directly. So there are challenges in getting information out in construction industry, depending on if the workers are working alone or working on multiple sites. So they thought this would be a potential different route to disseminate the information. So again, the intervention was a laminated document to withstand the elements and was a convenient form. So it was short and quick, and that the workers were each given three to share amongst their work, respective workplace back at their workplace. So here's just a picture of what the document looked like. It is older now, so part of my thesis will actually be reinventing this and going through it and seeing how we can change it up a little bit. But you can see that it does have some short, quick bullet points. Workers are able to see, you know, what hand arm vibration is, how common is it, quick pictures to show visually what they may be looking for there. And then there also was information for employers, so what they can do, again, kind of what we talked about here, about where their control strategies, intervention strategies, and how they can reduce exposure. So again, all the information from, you know, this hour presentation packed into one document that could be easily read, and then provided direction for where the workers could go for additional resources. So we, it was given to 100 construction workers. So again, through the occupational health clinic, as opposed to directly at the work site. And they filled out a questionnaire, and they had their hand arm vibration assessment at the clinic. And then 2 months later, a follow-up questionnaire was sent out, and unfortunately only 57 did provide results to this, but it still was able to indicate some interesting trends. So we also want to look at what kind of health and safety training they are receiving surrounding anti-vibration gloves and those control strategies, as well as hand-arm vibration. So were they getting that education within their workplaces? And we also want to look at, following the intervention, did they improve or did they increase their glove use? So more looking at it as a way of they receive this education and now are taking a step towards protecting themselves. So when we look at the results for the health and safety training, you can see at the top that very few workers indicated that they were receiving any training specifically related to hand arm vibration syndrome and anti-vibration gloves. So when we look at the regulated training and the mandatory training, you can see that the majority did indicate that they were receiving that, but specifically to hand arm vibration is potentially still lacking. In this case was the construction industry, but we wanted to know, again, was this an effective way of delivering an intervention for an occupational health and safety topic? So we wanted to know, again, they gave three copies of each resource to the workers. So we wanted to know, did they share this? So are you able to infiltrate the workplace through the occupational health clinic? So you can see that the mixes are the varying sharing for each of them is mixed. So you can see that the majority did share with their co-workers at 68%, and and less with the employer and supervisor. But this may also just be based on convenience. So when they return to their workplace, maybe they see their co-workers more than their supervisor, employer, that sort of thing. But when we look at the anti-vibration glove use before and after, so this was previously presented by Dr. Thompson and Dr. House, we did see a significant improvement in their anti-vibration glove use pre-education and post-education. So this was a significant difference of the workers reporting that only 4% wore anti-vibration gloves before and then up to over 50% afterwards. And then when we look at, we did a logistic regression to see what the key predictors of wearing your gloves were after. And we did find most significant predictors were sharing the resource with their supervisor and being employed at a workplace with more than 20 employees. So back to the previous one, we see that only 45% of the workers did share the resource with their supervisor, but they were actually the group that was most likely to continue wearing the gloves or begin wearing the gloves afterwards. So here this points to the importance of the supervisor and the role that they can play in improving and having their workers achieve health and safety behaviors. So again, that the workers who did share with their supervisor would be 6 times more likely to wear their gloves following the education resource intervention. Switching now to foot transmitted vibration, some research that's been done at CROSH by fellow researchers is looking at, again, some PPE solutions, although I guess can't stress enough the importance of engineering control strategies. But we did look at measuring mats, boots, and insoles. So they had a variety of commonly used anti-vibration or anti-fatigue matting that workers in the mining industry potentially will use when they're standing on a bolter or a jumbo operator or jumbo drill, sorry. And then we also had a variety of boots that are typically used, again, throughout the industry within Sudbury. And then insoles, so these would be anti-vibration insoles or insoles that would be anti-fatigue that, again, that were taken from insoles that are being used within the industry. And when we did do field testing and lab testing, the combination that seemed to reduce vibration the most was the combination of mat 1, boot 3, and insole 2. So the Center for Research in Occupational Safety and Health is continually working on developing these strategies and testing the variety of control strategies that are being utilized and then hopefully implemented within the field. All right, so I'll turn it over to Tammy to continue on.
Thanks. If you do have some information about what mat 1, boot 3, and insole 2 actually mean, you can email me and I'll share those specifics. We're almost ready to publicly indicate the manufacturers, but probably about another 3 weeks away before we can officially release that report. Okay, so just as a summary, today we've told you a little bit about whole body, hand, arm, and foot transmitted vibration and some of the challenges. So again, just to reiterate, depending on the type of vibration you're exposed to, your health risks are going to be different. So for your operators that are sitting and exposed to vibration, they're more likely to have problems associated with back disorders, neck disorders, gastrointestinal tract problems. If you're exposed to higher frequency at your segments, so hand, arm, or foot transmitted vibration, you're more likely to have the tingling and numbness that could lead to permanent neurological damage. Vascular problems, that's where you get the blanching of your fingers. You'll see the blanching of the toes as well. That can, again, is a permanent problem and decreased grip strength. So again, what I want to reiterate with segmental exposure in particular is the damage is permanent. Once it's happened, you can get some treatment from your physician, but it's not irreversible. So you really want to pay attention to those early warning signs of the higher frequency exposures. Some really good resources. These are out of the UK. They're written in general language. I find that probably one of the better written documents to try to explain why vibration is an issue we should be concerned about. So if you just Google hand arm vibration good practice guide, and the same for whole body, you'll be able to get a copy of those. They're PDFs. They allow you to use them and distribute them as long as you give them recognition. There's also some good information on the Health and Safety Executive website, again, coming out of Europe. Now, the reason the Europe is doing a little bit better than we are in Canada, again, is they actually have legislation that is very specific to how much vibration you can be exposed to. And once you're exposed to that level, you can no longer continue to operate, whether it's a drill or a piece of equipment. And so their safety associations, their safety groups have produced more documentation about control strategies and what the understanding is. As I said, if you're interested in measuring your own exposure to whole body vibration, there is a free app, so you can play around with that. I would say use it as a screening tool. If you consistently measure your exposure and you find that you're in that yellow or red, then at that point you'd want to look at perhaps consulting with folks even at OCAL. They can come in and do an assessment to help to determine whether you've got increased risk and you'd want to implement some controls. Just the other references for the presentation. We do research, as we said, at the Center for Research in Occupational Safety and Health through grants supported by the Ontario Ministry of Labour, WSIB, Heritage Funding Corporation, Goodman School of Mines, and NSERC. So thank you very much. And I think we may have a few minutes for questions. So Mal, you could come back up here as well. So I don't know if there are questions either online or questions from the audience.
Do we have any questions from the audience? And Chelsea's checking online right now to see if anyone online has any.
Okay, excellent.
Oh, here we go.
Where can you get the vibration gloves for home use?
So you can purchase them from, you're going to likely have to go within the Sudbury region to one of the safety supply stores. I recently actually just checked at your Canadian Tires, your Home Depot and Lowe's, and they don't carry any anti-vibration gloves. They may say impact, or but if they don't have that standard, what you want to do is read the fine print, and it should have that ISO standard on it in order to be able to say that it's truly a vibration glove. So if you go to, you know, Susie Sallow Safety, Auckland Grandeur, not saying that correctly, but some of those, the suppliers that will service your industry, they should have very specific, but it needs to say that ISO standard. They have to be full fingered. If they are selling them to you as a vibration glove and they don't have fingers, that is not an anti-vibration glove. It may deal with impact in the hand, but it is not dealing with vibration. So it has to be a full fingered, and it has to say that ISO or ANSI standard on it.
I had a question. When we're talking about things like, clearly for like low back pain, there's so many different reasons that that could be. But if we're talking about things like Raynaud's, are there other causes for Raynaud's, or is it just like, is it if a worker shows up with that diagnosis, then we should be looking at vibration?
There are non-occupational exposure causes. So some people could have Raynaud's of non-occupational origin. So your physician would do the initial assessment to determine whether there were other underlying factors. And then if those are ruled out, you know, a proper work history should then give some indication, okay, maybe vibration is a factor. And then that individual could be sent for testing to determine whether they have hand-arm vibration syndrome.
Well, online questions, Tammy. How does this pertain to riding lawnmowers at home?
Riding lawnmowers, you want to do that one? And Val's like, I don't know, sure? Okay, she said no. Okay, riding lawnmowers. So again, depending on how long your exposure is, right? Remember, we need to know duration of exposure. So if you're someone who's, you know, riding a lawnmower for a short period of time, you maybe don't have a really huge lawn. Yes, you would have whole body vibration exposure, but it's probably of a low enough exposure magnitude duration that you're not at increased risk for back problems. Now, having said that, if your regular job exposes you to whole body vibration and you really like your riding lawnmower, like you're on it for a good 3-4 hours on the weekend, every other day, you're doing your neighbor's lawn, maybe you have a large acreage, then yeah, there's a possibility that that additional exposure combined with possibly your occupational exposure could put you at increased risk for a vibration-related injury like low back, neck problems. So you could use the free app. I don't make anything from that, but you could, if you're worried about it, you could do the initial screening using that tool to determine whether you're in the yellow or the red.
Okay, and Tammy, as a follow-up to that, someone's actually asking, what is the name of the app?
I think I had the link there for where you can get it. I can't remember exactly what the app's called, but if you go to that website, if you go to ergonomicsuk.edu.au, basically, if you search there, or just send me an email and I'll send you the direct link. I can't tell you at the top of my head, but that's the pretty picture what it looks like.
Could they just search for vibration in the App Store?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah. Is that what you did?
Yeah.
Mallory probably should answer that question.
No, I'm there.
Okay, I've got another one for you from online. How do we know which anti-vibration gloves are best other than their ratings?
Do you want to answer that? No? Sorry. No. I'm going to make you answer one yet. Again, really, as long as if they've been tested and they're certified, then they're going to, as Mallory said, they're going to be able to say, okay, yes, we're going to attenuate at those higher frequencies, so above 200 hertz, and we're not going to amplify at the lower frequencies. But if you're really concerned, then, you know, it may be that there's additional testing required. So you would want to have some evaluation of what is the frequency that the tools that you're using are exposing you to. And then you could consult with some of the manufacturers to determine what their gloves have been tested for. But really, if they're not stamped and certified, then you don't have any indication that they're actually attenuating the higher frequencies. So you want to make sure it says that certification. But I think also, as Mallory alluded to, gloves are just, they're sort of your last barrier. I mean, what I would be encouraging people to do is to talk to the equipment manufacturers and see if there's some better tools that are there that are going to reduce your overall exposure. So if we can get the admissions values down, and there are tools that are being improved all the time, and particularly driven by the legislation that's in place in the UK. So for equipment manufacturers to sell their tools in Europe, they actually have to be able to prove that they will reduce their, they won't expose a worker above that standard over a typical 8-hour day. So there's improvements that are being made all the time. And so I think it's maybe asking, are there better tools that will have lower exposure? And then considering gloves as sort of your last option.
I've got another one here. Is it the stance of the MOL to utilize the EU vibration thresholds as best practice, i.e. that they would enforce it?
I can't speak for the Ministry of Labor, so I'm not sure if we have any Ministry of Labor reps here. The best of my understanding within Canada, again, there is no specific legislation or criterion value. So what the Ministry of Labor could use is that general duty clause. And in terms of then what value they would recommend, typically if we're asked to go in and do measurements for a company, if they've been concerned about their exposure, we'll indicate where they're lying with respect to the ISO standards. And in many cases, we'll often indicate where they're lying with respect to the EU guidelines as well. And then that information they can use to make decisions about control strategies within the workplace.
Just back to the riding lawnmower. It is an occupational riding lawnmower used for 6 hours a day.
You want to jump in now? 6 hours lawnmower?
So again, as Tammy mentioned, I would say that if it is an occupational exposure, so being 6 hours a day and continuous, depending on how long, how many shifts they're having per week and over the summer, then I would say that they definitely could be at risk for low back injury or other disorders associated with whole body vibration. So again, if there is manufactured guidelines for what the vibration emissions are for that equipment, or again, use something like the app to provide a screening tool or have measurements done. But definitely there would be a risk if it's used in an occupational setting in that regard.
Okay, any other questions at all? Oh, yes, we do. Okay.
So if you were going to use the app, is there a specific location? Is it like just in your pocket is fine, down on like on tape, duct taping it to the seat? Like,
yeah, so what you do want to, where you are, I guess I can show. But anyway, so what you do want to have is put it on the chair. So if you're, again, obviously the app is more for, is for the whole body vibration. So I don't know if Tammy or I could demonstrate either one. So what you do want to do is the app does show you how to arrange it. So you do want to make sure that you have the axes in the correct direction, but you do want to secure it as best as possible. So when we did some field testing measurements, we actually had it in a rubber seat pad, but that was designed ourselves. But what you do want to do is at least try and duct tape it down so that it is secure, and then you do want to sit on it right on, you know, right on the buttocks area, and try not to to shift around too much. Although it is not, it's not as comfortable, obviously, when it's just like that with the duct tape. Having it in the rubber seat pad is somewhat more comfortable. But again, just as a screening tool that is available out there for free, it has been showing that it is working well.
Yeah, and when you go to that website, they have a guidebook that tells you how to use it. And we've produced one as well for the mining industry, so it could be adapted for construction. So if you send us an email, we can send you the guidebook that we created that walks you through step by step how to use it.
This is going to be our last question.
Okay, I'll keep it brief. Do you know if Canada's moving in the direction of legislation toward this?
I don't think they are, and I think the legislation question is challenging. There's pros and cons to legislation. Obviously, it can be a driver for change, and we are seeing some positive changes in Europe. But I know they're also struggling. There are some challenges also with implementation in terms of enforcement. So if somebody is above, are there enough individuals there that can actually be evaluating all the industries where there's vibration exposure? I think from some of the work that Mallory's been doing, really what we, and events like this are perfect, it's getting the awareness out, because in many cases, individuals aren't even aware that vibration can expose them to increased risk for injury. So if we can get awareness of vibration out, start the conversation, have conversations with the Joint Health and Safety Committee about what vibration levels is the worker being exposed to, and then what are some of the controls that we can start to implement, then that's really, I think, the direction. And OCAL is a great resource. They've got information on vibration. They've got people there that can come and help do an initial screening. And obviously, if it's a bigger research question, we've got people locally in Sudbury that can take on those larger research questions to then work with our partners to come up with some solutions. So I think awareness is key.
Thank you.
Well, I'd like to thank Tammy and Mallory for coming today. Okay, so we're going to switch over to the next presentation, and I just got to do a little bit of setting up here. Okay, so the next presentation, ergonomic, yes, no, and maybe. I can figure out which button. Here we go. So over the years, many of you have heard me talk about ergonomic tools. Now, the ergonomic, always in quotation marks, is something ergonomic, is it not? So today, we're going to talk exactly about that. So let's remind ourselves of the main risk factors for injury. Posture, force, repetition, vibration, and temperature. An ergonomic tool or piece of equipment needs to address some, if not all, of these risk factors to truly be ergonomic. Oops. Bear with me. So to begin with, we've actually set this up as a bit of a game show. So I would like to invite Bonnie and Bob to come on up and take your respective spots at your podiums. Bonnie, Bob. Bob, you have a handheld mic. Bonnie, you can use the podium. So Bonnie, tell us a bit about yourself. And look straight ahead.
I'm an HR manager for Tick Machine Anishinaabe.
Perfect. And Bob.
I'm a supervisor at Valet at the laboratory.
Excellent. Okay, so the rules are simple. First one to say moo, when I show an image on the screen, gets a chance to answer first. The winner of today's competition gets a limited edition OCAL Stress Cow. Okay, this is what you're playing for today. Big money. So, remember, moo is what you need to do.
Moo.
Body. Ergonomic, yes, no, or maybe.
No.
Exactly, no. What we're seeing is a pull-out keyboard tray that is not height adjustable. Therefore, it does not address posture, force, repetition, vibration, or repetition. Are we ready for the next one?
Moo.
Bob.
Yes.
Bonnie?
Yes.
While it is height adjustable, it does come out, but that articulating platform on the slide, on the side, is actually about 3 inches lower than the keyboard. So as a result, when you're typing, you're leaning like this. At the same time, that little articulating platform is very flimsy, tippy, and unstable, which means the mouse is always falling on the floor. So as a result, your mouse is always falling. You are going to eventually put it on the desk and work with your arm extended, with half the people in the audience nodding their heads saying yes. Okay, here we go.
Nope.
Bonnie.
No.
Bob.
Yes.
Yes. The keyboard and the mouse are at the exact same level. The keyboard tray adjusts up and down, and it's got a wrist rest to help promote neutral posture of the wrists. Who's keeping score, by the way? I think we're tied right now, but yeah. Ernie, do you want to keep, Ernest, do you want to keep score? Perfect.
Moo.
Bonnie.
Yes.
Bob.
Yes.
I gave it a maybe. The problem with these ergonomic keyboards is that it assumes everyone's got the same size hands. So if you've got smaller hands, you can really be reaching in order to type on these keyboards. Coincidentally, I did an ergonomic assessment on a doctor who actually developed tennis elbow from using one of these keyboards. Because instead of typing like this, she was typing like this and developed irritation of the actual elbow. So I give this one a maybe. There are keyboards on the market that you can actually control the spacing for to fit your own hand size. That would ideally be preferable.
Moo?
Bob?
No.
No. This is always one of my favorite ones. My wife went to a Pampered Chef party, came home with a slap chop. Hey, look, honey, it's an ergonomic food chopper. Really? Force, I'm banging this thing. Repetition, I'm banging this thing. Posture, every time I hit it, my wrist is completely deviating. There's nothing ergonomic about it. You want an ergonomic food chopper? Get a food processor.
Moo.
Bunny.
Yes.
Yes. This paintbrush allows for neutral postures of the wrist. So when you're painting, your wrists are actually straight, as opposed to using a standard brush, where you're actually bending your wrists. So it's trying to promote a neutral posture of the wrist. You'll also see products like ergonomic knives for butchers that are out there with the same premise, helping to keep a neutral posture of the wrist when you're actually working. Office chair, it's kind of hard to see, but Bobby, you moved in first.
No.
No. The reason for that, the armrests on the chair are fixed. They do not adjust up and down. So as a result, if you're sitting and you're typing and you're using your armrests, your shoulders are going to be like this. You're going to end up experiencing neck and shoulder pain. Remember, the armrest should be positioned just below seated elbow height to let your arms move freely.
Moo.
Oh, okay. Help me out. Which one was that? That sounded like a tie. Okay, I'm going to go with Bonnie. Ladies first.
No.
No. The reason for that, well, there's no keyboard tray. His screen is definitely below seated elbow height. His chair is, well, I don't know what, like a kid's play school chair. Remember, ideally when we're in an office environment, the top of the monitor should be level with seated eye height. The keyboard and mouse should be directly at seated elbow height. So when we're using a laptop, ideally the laptop should only function as the monitor or even the hard drive. Ideally we want an external monitor plugged in that's height adjustable with an external keyboard and mouse that's height adjustable on a tray as well.
Moo.
Yes.
Bob.
No.
Both wrong. Maybe. The reason I gave this one a maybe is because the product does not come with instructions. When you go to the local hardware store and look at the ergonomic snow shovels, it's just there. So when you go out and actually watch people using them, shoveling the driveway, they're actually still grasping down at the bottom and shoveling like they would with a normal shovel, instead of using the upper two handhelds. So as a result, I give this one a maybe, just because of the fact that there's no clear instructions on how to use them.
Moo.
Okay, that doesn't sound very confident, but Bonnie, what do you think?
No.
No. The reason we say no to this one, these are actually armrests meant to keep your arms straight. Well, the problem is, one, they're not height adjustable, so you could be working like this. Two, that arm piece would actually create a pressure point on the other side of the arm, thereby cutting off blood flow and nerve supply. So yeah, a big no for that one. Ergonomic toothbrush.
Move.
Bob.
No.
No. The reason for this one, I say no for, is the actual duration and repetition. If the rationale for designing an ergonomic tool is to allow neutral postures of significant durations. If we brush our teeth like we're supposed to, 3 times a day, for about 3 minutes, or singing happy birthday, in case you didn't know that, yes, singing happy birthday. So as a result, it doesn't warrant the purchase of a $20 toothbrush. I'm not going to pay $20 for a toothbrush. So as a result, I gave this one a no. How about the height adjustable handles? Mm. Now this is multifactorial because it's going to be, the left and the right are both going to have answers.
Maybe.
Maybe for both of them? We have the lady and the man.
Yes, for both.
Okay, Bonnie, I'm going to give you a chance to answer.
No.
No for both of them?
Yeah.
Well, you get a half point. No for the lady, because the mop is way up over her head. Yes for the gentleman. A handle should actually be located at mid-chest height, be it a broom, a mop, a snow shovel. To allow for natural position, you want it located at mid-chest height. These handles are actually height adjustable. You just stand on the broom, twist the handle, you can bring it up, you can bring it down. They work for dust mops, mops, etc. Mop bucket. It's a two-part answer as well for this one. So think and then move.
Move.
Okay, Bob.
No for yellow and yes for the green.
Exactly. Give him 2 points for that one, Ernie. The reason for that, what's what we call the Tall Sally mop bucket. If you notice, it's flared on top and narrows at the bottom. It's also higher and has a longer handle. The important part, though, is the actual flare of the mop bucket. When you go to pour that initial bucket, about half the water is already gone with that initial pour. Compared to the yellow bucket, where you're basically, when you're going down, let's lift properly. When you're lifting properly and bringing that bucket up, you're lifting that weight throughout the entire lift. So as a result, the weight is a lot less for the Tall Sally. Okay, this is going to be a three-parter.
No.
Okay, Bonnie.
No, maybe, and a yes.
Bob?
I'll say yes for the first one and no for the other two.
3 points for Bob.
Wow.
The reason for that is that the handle, the toilet brush handle for the first one is longer. The other two, while they have a bend in the handle to try and promote a neutral posture, they're still the standard handle length. So as a result, with using the other two, if I'm still cleaning the toilet, I'm still down like this doing it, as opposed to being able to stand upright and use the toilet brush handle. Dustpan.
Moo.
Bob.
Yes.
Yes. Because as a result, it's got that longer handle. I'm no longer having to squat down to sweep up my dust or my dirt. I can stand straight and just sweep it on. So, that's it. Our winner, Ernie? Bob. Bob is our winner. Here's your stress cow. Thanks, Bonnie.
Thank you.
So, just to wrap it up in conclusion, just because something says it's ergonomic doesn't mean it is ergonomic. And so as a result, I always have to caution people, buyer beware before buying. I always say, see if you can actually pilot test a new tool or piece of equipment prior to buying. Now, I often give an example of a work site I was in just about a year ago. They spent $30,000 buying new office chairs for their staff. It turned out when I went into that work site, those office chairs only fit 25% of the population. So 75% of them, the chairs were too deep for. If you remember in previous years, I talked about seat depth. You should be able to put a fist between the front of the chair and the back of your leg. If you can't do that, you end up with a pressure point. Cuts off blood flow, cuts off nerve supply going into the legs. So as a result, this worksite, $30,000, only 25% of the staff could use it, so then they had to try and send them back to the manufacturer to see if they would take them back. Manufacturer said no. That's why it's so important to be able to try before you buy. Because as a result, this company's out about $20,000 because now they have to go back and get new chairs to fit the rest of the staff. Any questions at all? Chelsea, check in. No one has an example of a piece of equipment they want to know anything about? 2.0? Anything online, Chels? All right, well then we'll take a break. I do suggest to everyone, in your handouts, there is a copy of the presentations that were available at the time of sending them out, as well as evaluation forms for every presentation. Those online have the forms as well. Please take the time to fill them in. It's the only way we have of knowing A, how we did, but also B, ways we can improve, and also suggestions or ideas that we can do for future events. So that being said, we'll take about a 15-minute break and come back with ergonomics and driving. Thanks. Okay, so we are back. We're just waiting for them to get the presentation up. All right, so I'd like to introduce my friend and colleague, Brendan Millat from our Windsor office, who's going to be talking today about ergonomics and driving.
Good morning, everyone. There's some familiar faces out there. How many people were at the presentation last year at the RSI Day? Yeah, I thought I recognized some faces. So today what I'm going to talk about is ergonomics and driving, and I have a few slides on vibration, but it's really nice that Tammy was here and her student to talk about vibration, because it really is a significant hazard when it comes to driving. Luckily, I didn't have to drive here, although when my flight was coming in last night, he almost got onto the runway and took off again. That was a little interesting. And then we were up there for a while. I don't think they had the runway cleared off enough. And it was 50 degrees in Windsor when I left. Okay, so this is what I'm going to cover today. We'll talk about the physical musculoskeletal disorder hazards associated with driving. So this wasn't the stuff that Tammy covered necessarily. We'll talk about selecting a vehicle, because it's really important when you're going to be obviously providing a vehicle for a worker. And even for yourself, if you're looking to purchase a new vehicle, this is really important information. How many people here spend a significant amount of time on the road for their jobs? Quite a few. Okay. We'll talk about steps to prevent injury, working from your vehicle. Of those that do use their vehicle for work, how many people actually have to work from their vehicle? Okay. And then I'm going to cover off, because this is something we don't talk about a lot in ergonomics, is the human factor side. So this is what I did last year on my presentation, was talking about how we process information, how our bodies control movement. So I'm going to talk about that human factor cognitive side as it relates to driving as well. So this is just some statistics related to driving. On average, men drive 71 kilometers, women 55 kilometers each day. Studies have found that there's significant associations between driving and back problems. One study analysis said that the possible reason relating to the low back was, again, that long-term vibration exposure from the driving. And the highest risk is for the neck, the back, and the low back. So problems, again, the neck, back, and low back, and shoulder are usually the areas that people report having problems with driving. Even developing cramps and getting pressure points, because the blood gets down our legs real easy. It doesn't get back up as easy. In fact, you need to have that muscle pump effect. And when you're not moving, you don't get that. It's the same with sitting, right? Nick did the presentation last year on sitting. Well, this is sitting, and then it's compounded. So you don't get a lot of good circulation. This is the reason I actually, when I have to rent a car for work, which we have to do sometimes, I make sure that I get a car that has cruise control. Because one of the reasons is, because I do have this problem, mind you, I can't use cruise control all the time when the road conditions aren't the greatest. But what it allows me to do at least is to move around a little bit. You're at a real significant risk for a low back injury when you lift, especially when you're lifting after you've been driving. That's a significant hazard, so people have to be really careful when they have to do that type of task. And then there's that long-term potential for having disc degeneration and disc herniation, although the WSIB would say you don't get disc degeneration from work. Okay. So these are some activities. So think about this and think about yourselves if you do any of these activities. I'm sure, how many people would say they drive more than 30 kilometers per day even? So most people. So now you're at a 2 to 4 times higher risk for back pain. Truck driving, obviously, 4 times risk for disc ruptures. Car driving, because again, you probably don't have the amount of exposure with vibration in the car, although there is some. I love this app. I'm definitely downloading that app and trying it out for sure. And it's nice to know there's something out there, because I know as an organization, OCAL, we can't afford to buy accelerometers. Right? Because we get that. We get asked about doing assessments, and we can't do it because we don't have those. Although now that they have the app, I did not know that. I think that's great. If there is increased vibration, then that's going to increase the tension, the fatigue, and back pain, and then driving a bus. So who's at risk? Well, obviously anybody who drives. Truck drivers, ambulance drivers, heavy equipment operators, I would say are significant because, again, the amount of vibration they're exposed to, and just for the amount of times, obviously, that they spend. Bus drivers, forklift operators. So anybody working in a facility that, you know, the forklift drivers definitely are exposed. Farmers, delivery courier service workers, taxi limo drivers, traveling salespeople, consultants that are on the road a lot. I have a pre-existing back condition, and I know that sitting in general is bothersome for me. The nice thing, though, when you're in an office, at least, you have control, right? You don't have to necessarily sit for prolonged periods. However, people do just because out of habit. You know, I talked last year about how we're creatures of habit, but it's easier to move around. You don't have that control in a vehicle. You can't move around in the vehicle so much. But there are some things we'll talk about that you can do to reduce the risk. But that's the problem. I know I'm very challenged when I have to drive distances because I typically have to stop every hour because I just have, you know, so much pain. The longer I go, the more problematic it gets, especially when I'm driving. As a passenger, not as much because, again, I have more flexibility of moving around. So again, the two main hazards associated with the neck and back, sitting for prolonged periods of time, and whole body vibration. We've known for a long, long time that sitting is bad for your back. Well, this is the problem with driving. Now you're putting another layer. You're putting that vibration, and vibration is very damaging. So we have to think about you know, people that drive and the amount of risk that they're exposed to. So here's the hazards associated. So sitting is an awkward posture. And the reason it's awkward, when you're standing, your back is in neutral position, meaning you have the curvatures. You also, the thing with standing, the difference is, the forces that are going through your back are attenuating. They go up as they go down. Well, then you have your legs absorbing the force. When you sit down, what happens? Your legs aren't there anymore to absorb the force. So the forces go up 50% just by virtue of sitting. And that's if you're sitting properly and using the lumbar support and keeping that lower curvature in your spine. It's also static. And to me, in my opinion, static posture is the worst risk factor out of all of them. Because the muscles are, when you're sitting, you're not void of movement. And, well, I shouldn't say that. You're not void of muscle contraction. There's a lot of muscle contraction going on, in fact. So, but the problem is the muscle contraction is you're not moving, so you're not getting enough blood flow. And that's where you see the restriction in blood circulation through the muscles. That's going to fatigue the muscles the longer you sit and don't move. It is, like I said, it's a working posture. So the muscles are working. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to sit up straight, right? Right now, all of your muscles are contracting in your low back. Otherwise, you'd be falling off the chair. And over time, those forces increase. And the problem as well is not just the forces, but when you sit and you don't maintain the curve in your low back, the ligaments are what stabilize your joints. Every vertebrae to vertebrae is a joint. So you have ligaments that attach bone to bone. When you're sitting for prolonged periods, the ligaments get stretched. And over time, what happens is they can lose their elasticity. For some people with back problems, this is the problem. And I know for me, this is my problem. I have some disc degeneration. I'm not that old. But I have very loose ligaments. And once they're overstretched, it's done. There's no going back now and, you know, shortening them up. They can do that with your knee. You overstretch a ligament in your knee, they can go in there and do surgery. They can't do that in your back. They won't do it in your back. So once you have those loose ligaments, now it's done. So that's significant. So it's not just disc problems. Loose ligaments, overstretched ligaments can be very problematic. So this is just showing you your posture and your lumbar load. So you can see, you know, when you're sleeping, the idea is to reduce the load. It also allows your disc to refill with fluid. And then if standing is 100% of your force, just by virtue of sitting, it shows you it goes up. And then if you don't sit properly, why do you think, if you think about that last graph, think about why that would occur. It's because your head and torso have a weight. So that's actually what's increasing now the forces, because the weight of your head and torso is now creating a force in your back. So with long-term sitting, so there's correct driving position, right? You got your arms by your side. Also, you notice that driver is a little reclined. They say that's actually, you should be in a bit of a reclined position, because now the back of the seat in the vehicle is supporting the weight of your head and torso. So that will reduce the forces. Okay, so sitting is a static posture, but not void of muscle contraction. But here's the problem though, only some muscles are working, not all of them. So that's, again, another problem. So this is why having lumbar support is so important. Because when you sit, and if you don't have lumbar support, then you're going to flatten your back out. That's what you're going to do. Well, that's going to change the biomechanics in your spine. That'll increase the forces in the discs. It's going to increase that ligament length that I was talking about. And then you're going to get increased muscle tension. How many people have lumbar support in their vehicles? Okay. Unfortunately, my older vehicle did not, but I'll tell you, when I purchased a new vehicle, I made sure it had lumbar support. What I also ensured, because here's the thing, like with a vehicle, you have to pay, right? The better the features. But in the long term, if you do a lot of driving, it's worth it. So not only does my lumbar support go up and down, because we don't all have our curvatures in the same spot, right? So you want to be able to adjust the height of the lumbar support, but also even the depth. So my vehicle has that where I can change the depth. Now here's the problem for me. I have to rent vehicles. You know, I go and spend all this money on a nice vehicle with all of the features that I should have, and then sometimes I have to rent, and I don't always get a vehicle that has all of those features. So just, again, something to think about. So you have to support the curve in your back. That's when the low back, the lumbar spine, is in neutral position. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because Tammy talked about this. So it's just another layer with driving is having the whole body vibration. And she was talking about that resonant frequency, so that's the 3 to 5 hertz. So that's what our body vibrates at. The problem is that's what the vibration is in a vehicle that you're getting, and that's not good. That's what causes the problem, is because the vibration is the same. So again, long-term exposure, disc displacement, degeneration of the spine, you could get scoliosis, intervertebral disc disease, herniated discs, and she was mentioning about disorders of the gastrointestinal system. So how can you reduce the effects? Again, she spent a lot of time on this, but reducing the transmission, making sure vehicles are being maintained properly, proper engineering of the seat. She talked a lot about that. That's really important. And again, don't assume because it's labeled ergonomic that it is. Decreasing the amount of speed. That was, again, significant. She was talking about the speed of travel. And giving yourself maybe a little more time in between your exposures. Sometimes, obviously, that's difficult for people that are on the road all day long. And if possible, if you have control of this. We talk about this a lot when we go into plants for forklift drivers, is if they can at all kind of, you know, change up what they're doing, because sometimes they do other tasks as well. Part of the problem is, though, sometimes the tasks they're doing are manual material handling. Right, and remember, we'll talk about lifting after sitting and being exposed to that. Modifying the seat, having good backrest support, reducing that forward sideways leaning of the trunk, because she was talking about how much that can increase the risk, eliminating awkward postures, making sure that you can see properly, that you can see your displays. I have to be cognizant of that when I'm adjusting the steering wheel, is that I can obviously see my display very clearly, because that's going to impact. And if you can, reducing or isolating that vibration source. So let's talk about sitting or lifting after prolonged sitting. What does that say? The Healthy Back Book. Okay, so here are some tips to reduce the wrist. So obviously, you want to make sure if you are going to lift that you're using proper lifting techniques. You want to get as close to the object. So if for yourselves, for your own vehicles, you know, think about where you're positioning things in the trunk. I know I do that, you know, I really think about it when I'm putting my groceries in the trunk, that I keep things close. I even have bins that I put them in, because sometimes what ends up happening is some of the bags that I may have, or if I get bags, I end up with stuff at the back of the trunk. Like everything gets thrown all over the place. So it's important. Trying to park as close as possible to drop-off points. This is for manual material handling. I would tell you it would be the other way around. If you've been driving a long time and you're not going to have to manual handle, park as far away as you can. Because really what you want to do is move. We were designed to move. And the perfect movement for us as humans is walking. When you think about something that is neutral position, dynamic movement, low force, it's walking. Walking's the perfect movement. So if you've been driving for an extended period of time and you're getting somewhere, really that is the best thing you can do, is park as far away as possible and then walk. Maybe not on a day like today. But really make sure you take care when you're going to be handling manual material handling after you've been driving for a period of time. What we recommend, and see, this is hard to do, you know, I say it and sometimes I don't do it, is you need to get out and actually move around a little bit before you lift. You want to give your back that little bit of recovery, even if it's just walking around the vehicle. In my previous job, I would do a lot of implant training, and I would have, you know, a couple of boxes of material that I would have to transport from my car. Luckily, we had standards with that company. Nothing could be over 40 pounds. Although, having said that, 40 pounds for me would probably be like 80 pounds for someone else. But they did provide us with carts, so I would put the material on carts. I had a wheeled bag that had my laptop and everything in it. Sometimes I would definitely have to do 2 to 3 trips. And I know, again, sometimes people think, oh, just try and bring it all in at once. But again, you're better off to give yourself a little more time and do that. And then, of course, if you need assistance, is get assistance with that. Sometimes if I had stairs I'd have to climb, I would even organize that with the workplace before I got there. I would tell them, if you can have somebody available for me to assist me. So here are some just different lifting techniques from the trunk of your vehicle. So the idea with proper lifting is not necessarily squatting, right? Because, I mean, it's your trunk. You really can't do that. The goal for proper lifting is to keep your back in neutral position. So you can bend over, but you have to keep your lower spine in neutral, which means you have to keep that curve. So you have to pivot. That first picture really shows him pivoting from the hips and not flexing his spine. That's really important. That tripod lift in the middle is a really good one as well. It's like that teeter-totter effect. And then I've had to do that, the third one in some cases, depending on how far things have gotten into the trunk of my car. So here's some ideas on selecting a vehicle. So ergonomics is all about matching the work, the tools that workers are using, their workstations, to the worker. So it's all about the fit. So you have to ask yourself, does the vehicle fit me? Does it have the capability of fitting me? 20 years ago, 30 years ago, petite women, I would even say myself, probably could not have purchased a Ford F-150. And the car companies are pretty smart. They want to sell vehicles. So what do? They make them highly adjustable. That's why they have all these features, is so more people can drive them, more people can buy them. They're not stupid. But you have to think about that when you're getting into a vehicle, or when you're purchasing a vehicle, when you're renting a vehicle, when you're purchasing a vehicle for your workers. I had a worker who, I'm going to say he was about 6'2". His vehicle was a Chrysler minivan. The unfortunate thing was, it was an older one, and the vehicle, the seats did not adjust up and down. And here was his problem. When he would get to a stoplight, if it was a sunny day, he actually would have to crouch down to see the lights. You know, if you're the first person at the light, he would actually have to do that because he couldn't see the light. He would have, so there was an instance where if the seat would have been adjustable, right, but he could not do that. He couldn't adjust the seat. So really make sure that what you're getting, you can adjust to fit you. They even have now the accelerators and brakes, right, that go in and out. Think about where you're laying out things and what you need to have in the vehicle. I had a worker who had to have a lot of containers beside him in the vehicle, and he was constantly having to twist. And it actually wasn't a problem with the fact that he had the containers, it was the way he had to position them in his truck. And they probably should have even taken the seat out. He never had anyone in the vehicle with him, so they probably could have modified it to make it a lot better for him, because he was doing this constantly, taking folders and things out of the side, and he was having to twist a lot. So think about how much time you spend in the vehicle, how far you have to go, and again, does it have the features that will help you to assist in the things that you're doing? So the ideal thing is to have an adjustable seat incline. So again, it's at about 100 degrees. You don't want to be 90 degrees, right? If it means that you have to get a little bit closer so that you're, you know, inclined at about 100 degrees is the best positioning to be in. It's the same with an office chair. It would be the exact same thing. The changeable seat bottom depth, you know, I'm not sure how many vehicles have that, but adjustable seat height, obviously. The seat bottom incline, again, I can adjust that on my new Chrysler minivan. Having a firm foam, and it should be dense, that's what you want. You know, people think that soft is good. Soft is not good. It shouldn't be really cushiony. And, you know, it might be a matter of, depending on how much wear and tear, you may have to change that in a vehicle for workers. Having that adjustable lumbar support, again, not just up and down, but in and out, is really a good thing to have. Adjustable bilateral armrests, and then that adjustable head restraint. A lot of people don't adjust that too, by the way. I have to think about that. I don't do that all the time when I get a rental, and I've had to, you know, figure out a way to remind myself to do that, because that's an important safety feature, is you want that in the right spot. Again, you know, seat shock absorbers, you want to dampen that frequency. Tammy was saying this, between 1 and 20 hertz. Having that linear front back seat travel, again, to allow different size drivers to reach the pedals. I'll even change that up sometimes when I'm driving. I change up my steering wheel adjustment, and I'll change up that. While I'm driving, I'll do that sometimes. Just again, it's just so I'm using different muscle groups, changing up my positioning. I change up my hand position on the steering wheel quite a bit, just because sometimes I get sore just from not moving. So if you look at these two photos, the photo on the right A is showing you where the seat pan is too short, and vice versa, picture B is where it's too long. So neither of those are good. So you want to make sure that, again, your feet can operate the foot pedals without having to stretch. Your controls are within easy reach. All your display instruments can be seen from your driving position. And you have good all-around vision. I have to usually spend probably 15 to 20 minutes every time I get into a different vehicle trying to figure out where everything is, you know, adjusting my side view mirrors. I've had issues where I'm on the road, and because my windshield washers are on the right, and now they're on the left. It's amazing how much that can be a problem, right? When you're used to doing it a certain way. That's something you have to remember, too. When you're expecting people to rent vehicles a lot, how many people have to do that? Does anyone else have to rent vehicles quite a bit? So those are the things you want, and you want to make sure you check those out. But it is, it's true. The problem is, you know, when you have to do it and not think about it, you automatically go for what you're used to doing. And it can be really frustrating and scary at times. So this is showing you, you want to make sure that the backrest is wide enough to support your shoulders. The headrest, again, ensure the back of the headrest reaches your shoulders and it doesn't obstruct your rear view, rearward vision. The steering wheel, they go up and down, they go in and out. Power steering. I would hope most vehicles now have power steering, although I'm sure maybe in some older vehicles, trucks, they may not. That was my first car, I remember that. No power steering, no power brakes. You want to have everything centrally positioned and not offset. Again, you don't want to be rotating your spine in any way when you're driving. And make sure, again, that steering wheel doesn't obstruct the display panel, because that will force you to use awkward postures. What I'm really challenged with, I'll tell you, is because I wear glasses, I'll usually wear my single vision glasses when I'm driving. The problem is I can't read the instrument panel with that, which can be a problem. Which is why sometimes cruise control is good, then I know I'm not speeding. I do have progressive lenses, but it makes it really hard for me to try, because I have three. I've got the ones where I'm supposed to be reading, which I shouldn't be doing anyways when I'm driving. But, you know, that middle part is where I'm seeing the instrument panel. But with my progressive lenses, that spot's not big enough. It's a pain in the butt. I'm getting laser. Okay, steps to prevent injury. So make sure, this is important. People don't realize until they actually hurt their back. I learned how to get in and out of my vehicle properly, right? The idea is you're supposed to just sit down and then, you know, put your feet into the vehicle. But be cognizant of that, especially, again, if you've just been, you know, sitting for a long period of time, you get out for a short period, you get back in. Make sure you use good sitting posture position and try to, you know, move a little bit while you're driving. Change up that positioning. Again, backrest 100, 110 degrees, again, so you don't have that disc pressure. If possible, tilt the seat a notch back every 20, 30 minutes. This is what I do. Again, you're turning some muscles on, some off. So you're changing up at least what you're using. And it will alter the direction of the vibration as well. Adjust the steering wheel. Avoid slouching, because that's the problem. That is kind of where we go. When you start to get fatigued and your muscles get fatigued, that's why you sit that way. If possible, change up your position. Adjust the headrest. Adjust where you're positioning your arms. Changing your hand position on the steering wheel. If you can, take regular breaks. I stop. I really make it a habit of stopping every hour, because that's pretty much my limit for driving, if I'm driving. And even if I don't have to go in and, you know, use the washroom or get a coffee, even if I just walk around a little bit, it really does make a huge difference. And really, really important is try not to lift something immediately after, okay? Try to give yourself a couple of minutes. I wouldn't say even stretching. Moving. You want to get blood flow into the muscles. That's way more important, actually, than stretching. So, for those of you that have to work from your vehicles, some people have to, you know, I saw a few hands, they have to use their laptops. Some people do, you know, paperwork, mobile use, and manual material handling. I actually have talked to a few MOL inspectors, and I know in the construction industry, for example, I know in some cases when they go out to workplaces, they might, you know, if they're doing up orders, doing their reports, they can go into the workplace, get an office, sit down, you know. But some of them can't. You're on a construction site. There's really no office there. So a lot of them have to do this stuff from their vehicle. So it can become a problem. Because again, now you're, you know, sitting even longer in the vehicle. A lot of times you're twisting or leaning to one side because you're using the laptop or reading or whatever, and you're slouching. This is a study that was done where they looked at the best location for a computer. And A and B is actually the worst. So those are the two on the right because of the amount of twisting. So you got a lot of increased forces and increased risk to the low back in that position. The first one, if you can't see it, see, it's actually where the keyboard and the monitor are separate. So that was one of the best ones. And then if you can't do that, then D is actually the best position to use if you're having to. I think in most police vehicles, although I've never been in one, I'm just saying, I think D is where they would have their laptops. There's actually a few devices out there, because we researched this for some people, where you can put the laptop onto the steering wheel. And the reason we did this was because I know we were, again, talking with a couple of the MOL inspectors. They were saying they have to be in a position because I think they were said, you know, somebody said, well, try going in the passenger side and working with a laptop. Problem is, they said in some situations, they need to be able to maybe get out of there quickly. Got to remember, they're in a situation where they're writing up orders or doing a work stop, whatever. They want to be behind the steering wheel so they can get out of there if they have to. So these devices actually work quite well. And I'm going to provide my PowerPoint to either Trevor, or I'm going to send it to head office to be downloaded. So I will, on that slide, I will actually put the link to those devices in case somebody is looking to look into them. So let's talk about the human factor side. Speeding, fatigue, and distracted driving. They also had alcohol use, but I thought, you know what, I think it's 2016, I think we all know that drinking and driving is a problem, right? And actually, they relate to all three of these when it comes to that. So I didn't actually put that in here. But I will talk about speeding, because I don't think people realize that when you speed, the safety features can be breached once you pass a certain speed limit, speed threshold. They did a study. They sent out a questionnaire, and I think it was across Canada, and asked people. There's the myths and truths about some of these aspects. And I was shocked at how many people actually thought that speeding would not compromise these things. And that's absolutely false. So just because you have an anti-lock braking system, if you're speeding, that anti-lock braking system is not going to work the way it's supposed to, because you're not going to have enough time. It's not going to have enough time to do what it's supposed to do. Your brake assist, your electronic brake force distribution, the electronic stability control. So none of these features, once you get past a certain speed, are going to work properly. Fatigue is huge, I think. So some of the reasons people get fatigued, you know, having inadequate sleep, I should say. That's deep sleep. Obviously, drinking, medications, if you've been driving for prolonged periods of time, and even the time of day. I could be, you know, as rested, but I find definitely, you know, when it's dark out, it's definitely more fatiguing when I'm driving. And here's the deal. When you're sitting, you're not getting a lot of blood flow. And that includes to your brain. Like, that's why we've talked about sitting even for an office environment and sitting for too long. It's the same in a vehicle. So it's not just the fact that you've been maybe driving for 6 hours or, you know, it's at night. It's just the fact that if you drive for too long, you're not getting a lot of blood flow, and that's going to make you tired. So how does it affect the safety? Well, obviously you could be at risk for nodding off. You're going to have slower reaction times. So when you do have to react to something, it may not be fast enough. Your attention overall is going to be reduced. I find sometimes when I'm fatigued, I have to really start now thinking about where am I supposed to be getting off, because, again, we're creatures of habit. I've gone past, you know, an exit because I'm just doing what I usually do going home. Maybe I'm supposed to be going somewhere else and I'm tired. That's the problem. It's because you're not attending to things like you should be. Again, even slower decision-making times. Your delayed information processing. So, you know, seeing something, again, it's like it's similar to reaction time, but it doesn't even have to be motor reaction. It could be that thinking reaction time too. And Fatigue drivers are not very good at gauging how fatigued they are. So that can be a problem. And similar with speeding, your car safety features are going to become ineffective because you're not going to be using them at the right time. If you have a slowed reaction time and you're not hitting the brakes when you're supposed to, then those anti-lock brake systems aren't going to work because they don't have enough time. This came from Transport Canada. So with distracted driving, I go crazy when I see some people on their cell phones, just even on their cell phones. But I've seen people texting, and I still can't believe in this day and age that people still text. But again, we're so habituated, to doing things. And obviously a lot of young kids. I mean, I rarely use my phone to begin with because I'm just not in that age group. But that's the problem. The laws haven't been around that long, and they're so habituated to doing that, and they really do believe that they're going to be okay. They know what they're doing, and it's horrible. So fatal collisions where distraction was cited has risen. Well, obviously because of there's more people have cell phones. And they estimated that distracted driving accounted for 30 to 80% of collisions, and the majority of those were cell phone use. When I went to a conference, 7 or 8 years ago, when I used to work for IEPA, and we had a policy. This is the thing, too. I mean, now it's law, but when it wasn't law, we had a policy where we could not talk on our cell phones. And in fact, a couple of our consultants had been caught doing it, and they were written up, and they were told, do it a second time, you're out. They had zero tolerance for that. Because it's not, I think people have this misconception that it's when they're dialing, right? It's not talking on the phone. The problem is, they did this study, and I went to this workshop, it was a presentation, and the gentleman that was doing it actually, his daughter had been killed by a distracted driver, someone on their cell phone. It's the fact that that person that you're talking to on the phone is not in the vehicle with you. If you have somebody in your vehicle talking to you and you're driving in a snowstorm like we were last night, right? That's different. They see the hazards you're having to deal with. So that controls the conversation. When you're talking to somebody on the cell phone, they have no idea what you're dealing with on the road. So that's the problem. That's why even I believe it should just be not even hands-free, because that's when I was with IEPA WSPS, we couldn't even talk hands-free. That was not allowed. Cell phone use, sorry. I get really. So it's the most common form of distraction is using cell phones. When you're texting, 23 times more likely to be involved in a crash or a near crash event. 84% of distracted driving-related fatalities in the U.S. were tied to the general classification of carelessness or inattentiveness. And 80% of collisions and 65% of near collisions had some form of driver inattention as a contributing factor. So it's really hard. It's hard enough driving and having to deal with everything. And you have to think about young people. I mean, part of the problem is we're used to, when you've been driving for a lot of years, like some of us have, right, you develop motor programs for driving. And that's a good thing, because then we don't have to attend to as many things, right? We've learned to control those things and how to drive. That's the problem with young drivers, is they haven't developed those motor programs. So again, just think about it with your drivers in the workplace. Right, they're going to need more time and less distractions. That's why I think, what is it when they first get their, what is it, the G1? What's the first one? I don't have kids, so G1. So they're not even allowed to have other people in the vehicle. That's why, because their attention they get distracted. It shows you children are 4 times more distracting than adults as passengers, and infants are 8 times more distracting. Distracted drivers 3 times more likely to be in a crash than an attentive driver. And driver distraction, again, was a factor in 4 million motor vehicle accidents in North America. Cell phone use. So again, I would hope that nobody's using their cell phone unless they have, you know, Bluetooth, hands-free, right? I don't have any of that, which means I'm not using my cell phone. And most of the time, my phone is off. Like, I have it silenced anyway. And, you know, I think for some people, it's almost they need to put it in the back seat. This is a neat website. This is where I got some of the information on those myths and misconceptions. So if you want to go on there, there's the link. And again, the PowerPoint will be up on our webpage where the other PowerPoints are. So if you want to go in there and look at some of the myths and misconceptions about driving and how your brain, again, it's about how your brain affects the safety in the vehicle. There's also a WorkSafe BC. If you have workers that are truck drivers, there's a really good video. I think it's about 3 or 4 minutes long on truck driving and just the hazards, and it's specifically around the vibration and seating and sitting properly and getting out manual material handling and so on. And that's it. If we have any questions.
Thanks, Brenda. I have to say this was very, very eye-opening. So if you can't, for some reason, select a vehicle that already has all the features that make it perfect for you, or as perfect as it's going to get for you, for example, like say you're flying and you're renting a vehicle, are there any sort of add-ons that you could put on for, like, say, I don't know, for example, maybe like a seat cover that would reduce vibrations and or...
I'm not sure about a seat cover for vibration. I know in my old car, I would carry around a little Velcro lumbar support. You can get them for your office chair, because again, for me, having the lumbar support was important. So I did have that. I mean, you can roll up. My physio was saying, you know, stick a small towel into a nylon or a sock. The problem with that is it doesn't stay put. Like every time you move, now it's moving. So it's not a great solution. But if you can get something that at least Velcros, which they do have those, for the lumbar support. But definitely you want to make sure at a minimum that when you get in that vehicle, if you can't adjust it enough, then I would say you probably need to change out the vehicle. And know kind of approximately what type of vehicle. Like I know what vehicles I can drive comfortably. So even when I call and reserve sometimes, I'll see if I can get those vehicles.
Thanks, Brenda, too. You talked about proper positioning. For seating, when you get into the car, do you have a proper way of measuring where your proper location to the steering wheel would be?
Well, I try to position it so that my arms are by my side, right? So I try to get the steering wheel. You don't want to be too close because now you're going to compromise your safety with the airbag. So that's the thing, too, you have to think about. But definitely the angle. And I do change that up. I will change up the angle. I will even change up sometimes the distance of the steering wheel because the idea is you don't want to, you know, you've got that, you know, 3 and 6 or 9 and 2 or 11 and 2 position. The idea is just change it up, truly. But you want it, the best positioning is to be so that your arms are by your side so you're not reaching too much for the steering wheel, right? So that's what I would say for the positioning is sometimes I'll play around with that for a bit before I get it where I'm comfortable. But I change it up. I change up my steering wheel position while I'm driving.
And one other supplemental, you talked about the different stress factors. What about the hot and cold aspect?
Well, obviously if you're by yourself, you can control for that, right? Sometimes if you've got more people in the vehicle, that might be a little more challenging. Is that what you're talking about, or more for getting out of the vehicle, hot and cold?
No, I'm thinking for when you're ergonomically correct or for safety, like if your muscles are contracting or, like, you know, I'm thinking of winter driving and getting into cold vehicles and then warm vehicles. Is there anything about that?
Well, obviously even warming up the vehicle is you know, smart thing to do. I'm going to tell you another big pet peeve of mine is when I'm driving and I see people that haven't cleaned off their windows properly. That's really important. In fact, you can get a ticket. if all of your windows, because that's going to really compromise. But yeah, if you can give yourself enough time, obviously, to warm up the vehicle. You don't want to be too warm. Sometimes I find if I am a little fatigued, I find if it's too warm, I try to even keep it a little bit cooler, because that tends to kind of keep me a little more alert. But it's challenging if you have, you know, a bunch of people. Like I know last night coming in the shuttle, there were like seven of us in this minivan, and it was way too hot for me, although some of the other people were complaining. So, you know, that's always a challenge if you have more people in the vehicle.
We have a question online. You said not to twist when driving, so how should you check your blind spot properly?
That's a good question. You know, there is a way to set up your mirrors, number one, your side view mirrors properly. And my husband, I don't know if he got this from somebody at work, because that can help. But if you have your side view mirror set up properly, you really shouldn't have to twist too much to be checking your blind spots. You know, usually I can do it with slight rotation, but my side view mirrors have to be set up properly, which means that you almost have to twist your head a little bit, right? It's about having them adjusted properly. You could probably get something online about doing that too, but I wouldn't say don't check your blind spots, obviously, because that's really important. But again, it's vehicle selection, right? Some vehicles have more problems with that. So even thinking about that when you're purchasing, absolutely.
It was actually interesting, just personally, I had a rental car a couple months ago, and it actually had the blind spot detector on it now. It's a new feature.
Oh, there you go.
Freaked me out. This light was going on in my rear view or in my side passenger mirror, and I'm like, what the heck is that?
Yeah.
And turned out, I looked over my blind spot, and sure enough, there was a car there.
Yeah. You see, that's obviously they're putting these new features on. What did we have? We had a vehicle in Florida that would automatically slow down when you're getting too close. And when you're not used to that feature, it's great, but we weren't used to that feature. So I think we actually ended up disabling it because it was really freaking us out that all of a sudden the car would start slowing down and you've got your... It's my husband, he tailgates a little bit too much. That's another thing too, by the way. Tailgating is probably one of the worst things you can do when you're driving from a safety.
About the airbag, like I have short legs, so how close can the steering wheel be to my stomach?
See, with short legs, that's probably where you want to have a vehicle where the pedals adjust. That's why they have that feature now, so that you don't have to now compromise with the steering wheel. You should be able to bring your accelerator and brake closer so that you don't have to then make yourself closer to the steering wheel. Again, just something to think about when you're purchasing your next vehicle, because they have them now in a lot of cars, not just trucks, but cars for that exact reason. Because of the airbag. Yeah, you're so close.
What's the safe distance for when you can't adjust the pedals?
You know what? Now you're kind of getting out of my realm of, I'm not sure. You'd have to probably ask, you know, somebody in the car industry, or I'm not sure on that.
Questions for Brenda at all? Okay. Brenda, I don't know if you just want to touch lightly on ulnar neuropathy and long-haul truck drivers?
On ulnar neuropathy?
Mm-hmm.
That's just when you're getting compression on the elbow. There's any joint, any area where you don't have a lot of soft tissue, muscle, fat, those areas are accessible to contact stress. So for the wrist, when you're on a computer at work, right, resting your wrists, can actually damage the soft tissue, the nerves, the tendons, the ligaments. Well, it's the same with the elbow. So you've got nerves in there that pass through the elbow joint, so when you're leaning all the time, then you could actually be at risk for damaging that nerve. So again, something to think about when you're driving. It's really about just trying to change it up as much as possible. You have to think about that, you know, movement, changing up your positioning.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Brenda.
Okay, thank you.
We're actually running a bit ahead of schedule, so we're going to take about another 15-minute break just to get everyone up and stretching.
Yes.
And just to switch it up, as Brenda's saying.
And we'll come back in another 15 minutes for our final presentation.
do yours first, and then. Oh, really? I had them there. For Mike, he controls that, so we don't have to turn it on or off.
No, you don't.
No, he said no.
Is anyone using this chair?
He said no, they're all on. They're all on right now.
Yeah,
I can
anymore.
Bring this here.
Start again. Okay, so we are moving on to our final presentation of the day. I will be presenting with two of our newest ergonomists, Chelsea DeRoche, who is our new ergonomist for our Ottawa clinic, and Alicia Canning, who is filling in for my colleague who's on leave right now.
So. Take it up. Okay. When workers think of personal protective equipment, they usually associate it with safety and proactiveness in the workplace. And by definition, personal protective equipment, or PPE, are tools that will protect the user against risks at work. So this can include anything from safety helmets to gloves, eye protection, high visibility clothing, safety footwear, and safety harnesses. What many of us don't realize is that there are risks associated with the use of PPE if it's not selected or worn appropriately. PPE should be selected by considering the type of hazard and the degree of protection required for the actual task in question. Selecting the proper PPE is really important in order to reduce the risk of musculoskeletal disorders. So to exemplify this, we'll be talking about work gloves today. Work gloves are typically used across all sectors, and they have many benefits, so they're often considered to be a staple in the workplace. And that's the case because they can protect from the cold, they offer protection from sharp and rigid materials, And they offer protection from the skin from chemicals and allergens that may cause allergic contact dermatitis or even irritant contact dermatitis. You might be surprised to find out that work gloves can reduce strength and increase effort in power and pinch grip tasks. They reduce manual dexterity and tactile sensations, and they can also reduce performance, and that's especially the case in cold environments. So we're going to be looking at each of these risk factors in further detail today so you can better understand our concerns from an ergonomic standpoint. And we also want you to reduce the effects of these risks in the workplace. So as I mentioned, selection is really important, and that's the case because we want you to get the right size. When gloves are too small, they decrease blood flow to the fingertips, which eventually leads to pain, numbness, and muscle fatigue. It also constrains finger and hand movements, which can increase perspiration. On the flip side, when the gloves are too large, it contains extra material. So that can really get in the way, and fingers tend to slide around the glove. That's especially concerning if you're working with machinery or anything with pinch points that can grab the glove and lead to a traumatic injury. Large gloves also impair fine motor performance and manual dexterity, and strength is decreased, so more effort is needed to complete a task. Manual dexterity refers to the ability to make coordinated hand and finger movements to grasp and manipulate objects. And when you have less manual dexterity, more strength is required to complete a task, and you have a decrease in performance. And I actually want to test this hypothesis today. I have a dynamometer and I have work gloves, so I want to see how strength is affected by the use of work gloves that are too large. I actually tracked down some participants today. Okay. Jennifer, do you mind coming up to the front for a quick second? So what I want you to do is I want you to give your absolute maximal exertion. So all you have to do is stand with your arms to the side and squeeze as hard as you possibly can. You're going to do this twice, one with work gloves and once without. Yeah, I heard that too. So you got about 29 pounds. Now we can try that again. Sorry, 29 kilograms. 29 kilograms. We're good. Now try that again with the work glove. Yeah. So you got to remember that these work gloves are considered to be large for Jennifer. Yeah. This time you got 20. Thank you. So you can see that there's a major reduction in the strength when she's wearing those work gloves. So even though she's giving her absolute maximal effort both times, we're not necessarily getting the same result in terms of strength. So that's what I mean by more strength is required to complete a task. My remote's over here. Work gloves can also affect tactile sensation. And that's the case because there's a lack of sensory feedback. And when that's the case, you have more strength is required to complete a task once again, and you have an increased effort in power and pinch grip tasks. So again, I have a little activity for you guys today. If I can get two participants. Anyone else care to participate? Perfect. So we're gonna have a little bit of a race today. What I want you to do is I want you to pick up these mixtures of nails and screws and place them in the bucket one at a time as fast as you possibly can. Now you'll be wearing work gloves. There you go. And you will not be using work gloves.
So when do it again?
As soon as I say go. Are you ready? One, two, three, go. Thank you. think we have an obvious winner here. I don't have a cow for you guys, but I'll be sure to mail it out to you. Thank you very much. So you can really see through that experiment that tactile sensation is really affected. So when you're gripping small and medium-sized objects, it relies more on your vision than your sense of touch because you can't necessarily feel the object that you're trying to grasp. And that's the same principle if you picture yourself holding a sewing needle between your fingers. Fairly light object. Barely any pressure would be required to successfully hold on to that needle. But if you were wearing work gloves, you would tend to grip a lot harder. And again, that's the case because you can't feel the objects between your fingers. They also say that tactile sensation is affected due to an increase in finger spacing while you're wearing gloves. So you get that extra material basically between your fingers. And that reduces maximal grip force, and it increases forearm muscle activation during the gripping task. So over the course of the day, if you're using more strength, that can lead to muscle fatigue. For many occupations, working in cold environments is part of the daily work. And so hand protection is considered necessary. What we want to achieve is to have local thermal comfort, all while allowing enough precision for safe and effective work. Now, research shows that performance is decreased when the skin temperature falls below 24 degrees Celsius. And at this point, your hand dexterity is also impeded. We also know that mitts can hold more body temperature than gloves. So where do we go from here? Well, I always want you to measure your hand before purchasing work gloves. You can measure your hand with a tailor's tape around the hand, just below the knuckles and fingers, but above the thumb, as indicated in the photograph. You want to measure your dominant hand. It tends to be slightly larger, so you always want to measure that one. And you want to consult the size chart. Those are often available in the store and even online. So don't guess your size. Don't take the gloves that are readily available at your work. Make sure you have the appropriate size. You also want to consider the tasks and exposures. So the temperatures you're working in, the chemicals you're exposed to, whether or not you're working with sharps or tools, and how much dexterity is needed for the work. Gloves with rubber palms increase friction between the object and the glove surface. So if you're working with tools throughout the day or if you're required to lift objects, this could be one of the recommendations because less gripping strength would be required. And gloves with textured fingertips provide sensory feedback for improved manual tasks via tactile sensations. So you can see that there's a bunch of little rubber beads on the gloves. So what happens is when you grasp onto something, it kind of puts pressure into your fingers, so you have an increase in tactile sensation. When you're working in the cold, we recommend a multi-layer approach. So what you want to do is you want to put an inner layer of thin gloves, and you want to put mitts over top of that. When dexterity is not needed, you keep the mitts on to make sure that your hands stay warm. And if dexterity is needed, you remove the mitt, and you work with the inner layer of thin gloves. We also recommend a four-compartment configuration for the gloves. So you would have an individual compartment for the thumb, for the index finger, and for the middle finger. And your last two fingers would be in a compartment together. So this appeared to be most promising in terms of protection and dexterity. So the theory behind that is that these two fingers would stay together to hold in that heat, and then you'd have the other fingers for manual precision tasks.
So, what's the main risk factor that can, or a diagnosis that can result from this task? Carpal tunnel syndrome, as well as tenosynovitis of the finger flexors. The main symptoms of carpal tunnel syndrome are numbness, tingling at night, and a reduction in grip strength. Risk factors, non-neutral postures, repetition, excessive force, and vibration. So when Chelsea was given the example of the gloves, because we've lost that tactile sensation and the experiment she showed with the diameter, what happens is you need to actually squeeze harder to do the task. So if I'm, for example, working out with a jackhammer, I got my gloves on, got to keep my hands protected, use my jackhammer, and now because I can't feel how hard I'm squeezing, I'm now gripping harder. So as a result, By squeezing harder, my muscles are no longer nice and loose. They're very hard, very rigid. So that actually increases the rate of vibration absorption into the body, increasing the risk. At the same time, another example of force is also the gross versus pinch grip. So we saw with the task here, when they were picking up the screws and putting them in, when you were in the gloves, you had to use a pinch grip because you had to pick up a small object. Well, why is pinching bad? Well, if this remote weighed 10 pounds, if I use my whole hand to lift it, we can simplify it to say I've got about 2 pounds of force being exerted between my four fingers and my thumb. But if I use a pinch grip, I've now got 5 pounds of force being exerted by my thumb and my index finger. So I'm exerting more force on a smaller number of muscles. Now, carpal tunnel syndrome itself is a disorder of the carpal tunnel. The carpal tunnel is made up of the bones of the wrist, the tendon flexors that let us move our fingers, the median nerve, which gives us the electrical stimulation to move our muscles, and this is covered up by something called the transverse carpal ligament, which holds everything into place. Now, each tendon within that carpal tunnel has what around it is called a synovial sheath. The sheath basically acts like a lubricant. So as the muscles are moving, they're sliding back and forth. If they become irritated due to vibration, repetition, high forces, it secretes a fluid to keep the tendons moving smoothly within that synovial sheath. The problem, though, is that this is a very fixed space. You've got that ligament holding everything in place. So we repeat it, use the gloves, for example, repeat it gripping, repeat it vibration exposure. These tendons begin to swell. And as they swell, they force the median nerve up against that transverse carpal ligament. That's where the numbness comes from. Because of the fact that nerve is now being pinched against the transverse ligament, the numbness is coming because basically it has nowhere to go and it's falling asleep. So in this example, you can actually see, briefly, the tendons that are moving inside that synovial sheath. So it's that irritation, that swelling, that causes the actual carpal tunnel syndrome symptoms to be experienced. Oh, there it goes again. There we go. Again? Nope. So as I said, the causes, pinching and vibration, are the most common related factors that result from use of gloves.
So another commonly used PPP in the workplace today, are work boots. We often, workers are often required to wear work boots throughout their whole shift, typically sometimes even every day. So it's important to understand the different types of work boots available for the workers to determine which are the best fit. I kind of scoped out everyone's footwear today, didn't really see any work boots, but we'll go through two common work boots that are found in the workplace. So one is composite toe, and a steel toe work boot. So for the composite toe, they're made out of non-metal materials, such as Kevlar, carbon fiber, plastic, and fiberglass, whereas steel toe work boots, as the name suggests, are made out of steel in the toe area. Both these types of work boots are to protect your feet, specifically the toes, from getting crushed or pierced on the job. So now I'll take, throughout the next couple slides, I'll go into detail on the risks and benefits of each work boot. For the composite safety toe boots, some of the advantages of these work boots is that they're more comfortable. So for workers wearing them for longer periods of time, this would be a best fit. They're warmer during colder periods, so on a day like today, working outdoors, these boots would be great. They're lighter, meaning you'll expend less energy throughout the day. They're significantly better electrical resistance than steel toe, so those electricians, great boot for you. They're also convenient for passing through metal detectors. Some of the disadvantages of composite toe work boots is that they're less strong and durable, so they won't last as long, and they tend to be more expensive. As for our steel toe work boots, They're more cost effective, stronger, and offer more protection. They're great for very hazardous working environments because they're known to be shatterproof. Again, they're widely known and accepted in the workplace, and some of the disadvantages is that they make your feet feel colder during colder climates and warmer during warmer climates. The reason behind this is that they're made out of metal, and metal conducts heat. Another disadvantage is that they are heavier. So it's very important for the workers to understand the different type of work boots available to them, especially when they're spending the majority, if not all, their time working on their feet.
So some of the health effects from working on your feet, both prolonged standing, fatigue, we just generally get tired more. Neck and shoulder pain, large amount of back pain, knee pain, varicose veins, that's a huge one in hairdressers, believe it or not. And of course, foot and bunion pain as well. Now, beyond simple fatigue and discomfort, we can also see more serious health effects resulting from working on your feet, which include low back pain, painful feet and other foot problems, plantar fasciitis and heel spurs, orthopedic changes in the foot. As we stand on our feet all day long, gravity's pushing down on us. And over years of working on our feet, that arch of our foot actually begins to flatten. Restricted blood flow from standing, swelling on the legs and feet, varicose veins, and increased risk of arthritis in the knees and in the hips. Now, one of the most common causes of foot pain is plantar fasciitis. Who's heard of it here before? It's about half. So basically, the plantar fascia is a ligament that connects your heel bone to your toes. It supports the arch of the foot and acts as a shock absorber. Causes of pain are increased standing, walking, or running, different surfaces, the type of shoes you're wearing, being overweight, and also overuse. So what happens, this is the example I gave of gravity. We actually lose the arch of our foot. So as a result, with years of working on our feet, that plantar fascia gets stretched. And it's when it gets stretched, where it inserts at the heel, that's where the pain begins to arise from. So signs and symptoms of plantar fasciitis, sharp pain upon initial standing, it improves with a few steps, then worsens with weight bearing. Tenderness when palpating the medial tubercle of the calcaneus or arch area. And it's a dull, achy, constant pain after periods of rest throughout the day. Now, some people are actually genetically more prone to plantar fasciitis. Anatomically, some people have a low arch or a higher arch, obesity, unequal leg length, or loss of the fat pad on the base of the foot. Biomechanically, you have a very tight Achilles tendon, weak plantar flexor muscles, or their foot does excessive pronation. So they've actually kind of almost like a club foot. So the foot rotates in more, which also causes stretching of the plantar fascia. Environmental factors can include trauma, increase in activity, working on hard surfaces, working barefoot, which hope not, poor footwear, prolonged weight bearing, and inadequate stretching. Another part of the body prone to it is low back pain. More specifically, the back muscles than anything, because of the fact that while we're working, our back muscles are working to keep us standing upright. Now, Alicia's going to get into this a bit more in her talk, but as we walk, we're hitting the ground. That hitting, that transmission, gets transmitted up our back. It can actually cause tiring or fatigue of our back muscles. Now, we can also find back pain coming from those people who have trouble with the intervertebral discs, where they've got loss of disc space. The discs are there to act as a shock absorber to keep those two bones of the vertebrae in between each one from rubbing together. So when we're walking on the ground, if you're losing that disc space, those bones are actually more likely to bounce off each other and increase the risk of lower back pain that way. So cause of low back pain related to boots, prolonged standing, walking, hard floors, heavy boots, poor footwear, and loss of traction.
So how many of you heard of ErgoMates before? Not many, eh? Well, this has the term ErgoMates, ergonomically correct. So in order to reduce back pain, low back pain, and plantar fasciitis, we recommend wearing ErgoMates. I have a pair here today. They come in different sizes. This is a medium, and in a couple slides, maybe I'll get someone to come up and try them out, to wear one on one foot and then their regular shoe on the other to experience what they feel like. So what are ErgoMates? Well, ErgoMates provide the same relief as an anti-fatigue mat. They're used while being mobile on a job, so they're not good if a worker is static in, working in the same area at the same time. They're good if the worker is walking around on hard surfaces. They also claim to have an anti-slip property. Anti-fatigue mats, on the other hand, are designed to reduce fatigue and muscle loading when standing for long periods of time on hard surfaces. For example, cashiers. We've all seen those new mats come into play within the last couple of years where they're all required to have an anti-fatigue mat. I've actually gotten one at my kitchen sink to maybe help my boyfriend do dishes with me, but I don't know if it works that well. The problem with these mats is that they're designed for static work. So therefore, ErgoMates would come in and they would help, they would allow the worker to be mobile. So if I'd like to get a couple volunteers, two volunteers to try one on one foot and then have their regular shoe, if someone's interested. Thank you. We'll send your cow in the mail. Anyone else want to try these? You'll be happy to hear, well, sure. They're roughly $50, so a little bit expensive. What's that?
May not fit his foot. Oh, wow. Sure.
Well, try. No, you leave your shoe on. Yeah, so they just strap on your shoe. We'll go back to that picture. Your shoe or your work boot. Thanks, Joe. I'll still send you a cow.
I got some more.
You could leave your shoe on and just slide it in. Oh, you're good. So you could find these ErgoMates actually at Lowe's. I've checked at Canadian Tire, Home Hardware. No luck yet. But
Athens Granger, Susie Sallow.
There we go. Found them at Lowe's. They're roughly $50, $60.
Will you marry me?
I feel like it's
good job, Trevor. Like so what you'll feel walking in them is softer, walking on a cloud. We often get those types of comments.
May I go nuts with this?
Yeah, go for it, Trevor.
You hear the difference.
You'd actually feel in... Yeah. Without the ErgoMate, you could still feel it tingling in your heel, whereas with the ErgoMate, less impact.
And then, of course, the anti-slip.
Don't twist your knee.
Come on, baby.
Okay.
Goodbye. Yeah. Sure.
Great. Thank you. So research suggests that ErgoMates improve loading rate and center pressure differences, which may affect muscle contraction in the kinetic chain, therefore increasing comfort. They have some protective aspects against MSDs by reducing the load rate during heel strike, thus reducing impact shock, which Trevor just demonstrated. Again, they're beneficial for preventing MSDs, reducing fatigue, and reducing slipping. So what type of workers would wear these ErgoMates? The workers should wear them when they're exposed to prolonged standing and walking. Because when we walk, we have that repetitive heel strike motion, causing an impact throughout the body, which is reduced with the ErgoMates. Workers should also wear these when repetition, force, vibration are present and when standing on hard floor surfaces such as tiles or concrete. We've just been briefly talking. Some of the unfortunate things about these is that they tend to be a little bit bulky. So for those workers that have to go outside, get their equipment, come back in, maybe they could start designing a type of slipper to go over top. I've seen some workers, Bell, for example, if they have to come in your house, they'll put these slippers on. Maybe that's something in the future they could think of for these ergomates to reduce putting them on and off. Because, like we saw, it takes a little bit to get them strapped on. That concludes our presentation for today. Question period.
Well, actually, I've got something to add about the ergomates.
Yep, go for it.
We did a research study a couple years ago at a local nursing home. And what we did is we actually walked in and we said to the staff, we want you to rate your level of energy, your discomfort at the end of the day. So we had them do that one day wearing normal footwear and the next day using the ergomates. One lady commented by the end of the process, for the first time in 15 years, she felt like she had enough energy to go home, clean her house, and go grocery shopping for the first time. So that's where the whole fatigue comes in, because it's not just the impact. It's your legs get fatigued, your back gets fatigued, it's the shoulders. It transmits through the entire body. So as a result, it helps recover the energy within your body so you're not actually experiencing that sort of whole body by the end of the day. Okay, now we'll open up the floor to any questions at all. Run the mic, please.
Our work boots at work are CSA certified. With ergomates, is there any kind of certification on them or on the instructions or anything that may hamper the CSA certification on work boots?
That's something I'm not really sure of, to tell the honest truth.
Any other questions?
Did you had a chance to try the ergomates on miners' boots? And my second question, if you had a chance to test it when actually person driving a vehicle with it, heavy equipment?
They really can't be used for mining work because of the fact they're really only designed for indoor use. When you get into a mine, for example, it's a lot of stones, a lot of rocks. The ergomates themselves, the sole, are made up of a little piece of rubber intertwined. So if you got rocks, for example, inside of it, it would lose any sort of shock transmission ability. That's why sort of Alicia's comment about some form of cover or something to go on top of them would be beneficial because then it could prevent the stones from getting inside. Your second question was driving a vehicle. I wouldn't because of the fact it's still a strap-on, it's still a bulky addition going on to the boot, so I'd be worried about an additional sort of safety concern when it comes to having this, you know, some that could get hooked under the pedal, for example. I would be taking them off before you operate any heavy equipment.
Can you tell me how they would work towards, let's say, cleaning chemicals? Would it break down? Would it stand up to it?
They were actually originally designed with for custodians. So as a result, waxing, stripping, etc. So they stand up quite well, as far as I'm aware of from talking to the company, because that was their original target audience when making the product.
They're actually quite light. I just wanted to note, I forgot to mention that.
And they come in white as well.
Because that won't get dirty. No.
There's a question over there.
Denis Dalcoy.
Did you guys want to see them? Yeah.
Can you use these for running? Like if you go on a treadmill and whatever, like would it help?
I
probably. Just once again, it's to me, it's a bit of a safety concern, just because of the bulkiness going over top of your footwear. But it would give that extra cushioning to help reduce that foot pain. In theory, however, as I said, there is that safety implication that I would have some concern about. There also has been some concern from people over climbing stairs. The front of it, because it is sort of bowed forward, a foot getting caught on metal stairs, for example, when bringing your foot up, there has been some safety concerns raised about that. So ideally, a flat level working area, you know, like a warehouse, something like that, is, you know, the ideal working situation for them.
So we have several questions from online. One of them is, how long do they last? So, and then the other, I'll condense them because they're all sort of related.
Okay, Andy, let me answer the first one because I'll forget any other question you ask me. That's what happens when you get over 40. The duration of use depends on how often you wear them. No, ideally, the maximum time period is about 6 months. So, you know, about $100 a year you'd be paying in order to get 2 cents.
And questions just keep rolling in. But that's good. So I've got one of them asks, in a nursing home, is there any comments from infection control with the non-skid surface? And then a related one is, if in that same setting, if you're walking very quickly, which is common in long-term care, is there an increase in tripping hazards?
Okay. So let's address the tripping hazard one first. As I said, if there's stairs, there is an increased likelihood that you could, you know, get your foot caught because you're not. The fact is, you've got an extra inch of material on the base of your foot, so you have to be aware to bring your foot up more. In terms of slipping on, you know, just a standard floor, no, because it's got that anti-traction, anti-slip property built into it. From infectious disease point of view, well, the only comment I've received is that, you know, there was a facility that had a concern. My response to them was, it would be treated as you would treat your normal footwear. So if you're having to sanitize, wash your footwear, then you would do the same with the ergomates. You just wouldn't put them in the dryer because they'll melt. So you would treat the ergomates the same way from an infectious disease point of view that you would your standard footwear.
And then just the last one, because there was a question about whether the ergomate would alter the original design of the shoe, but I think you covered that earlier. But the other one is, how thick is the padding?
I think it's about an inch.
Yeah, a bit less.
It's about an inch.
About an inch.
Oh, Denise at the back.
Are you aware of any footwear that it deals with uneven ground?
No.
Not at all?
No. You're looking, talking about ankle rollovers in an underground environment, etc. You can't, nothing will account for, you know, underground work. I mean, it's so uneven, puddles, etc. Nothing has been designed to accommodate that. It's almost like you need a robot shoe or something. Yeah. We actually did a study with underground miners on two different types of work boots. And what we found was, depending how you walk, because we did this with the Crosh Lab from where Dr. Eager comes from, how you walk actually determined which type of safety boot was better for you. Certain people, the way they walked, were more likely to have an ankle rollover wearing one type of boot compared to another. So that was sort of a very interesting thing, in that it's not just buying a boot. Sometimes there's a bit more science that needs to go into making sure you're selecting the product that's right for you. Denny?
So earlier on in the presentation, you were mentioning hand protection, and you were talking about increased force required when wearing work gloves. In our operations, we work outside. You mentioned about trying to maintain heat. Is there any kind of technology, like you were mentioning technology with the footwear, is there any kind of technology to keep your hands warm at the same time while reducing the requirement for using excessive force when in the workplace?
Well, as I mentioned, there's that multi-layer approach that we can do. So you can wear a thinner glove with the mitt on top of it, but if you need manual precision, then you're not going to be able to work with the mitt on. But Trevor, can you think of Like there's the four compartment glove as well.
They have battery heated gloves. Yeah, I was just saying they have battery heated gloves to help keep your hands warm. My sister-in-law had one at Christmas. It's actually a fleece as well to help keep her upper body warm. And she could actually adjust the heat setting that way. You can get heated gloves to help reduce the need for thicker gloves or layering as well. That's always an option as well. The biggest thing is making sure they fit properly.
So there's this comment that two comments that just came in. One is Impacto Protective Products has never had a return or negative comment on the ErgoMates with regards to trips and falls, and that proper sizing and ensuring the product isn't too large for the foot is a very important factor when selecting footwear or footwear accessories to reduce tripping.
Exactly.
It doesn't come in like specific size 7, 8, 9, 10. It's medium, large, extra large. So it would be beneficial to try them on with that boot that you'll be wearing, whether it's your work boot, a running shoe, because it might fit differently.
And as I've always been a big advocate of try before you buy. Be it a heavy-duty piece of equipment to an office chair. You always want to make sure what you're going to be purchasing suits the individual it's going to be used for. So you don't go out and buy a new car without test driving it. Why would you go out and say buy a bunch of office chairs without having people sit in them to see if it's comfortable? I gave the example of that $30,000 that was wasted by that one company because they didn't actually follow that procedure. Any other questions? Oh, over here, Dave.
I'm wearing a pedometer just for your information.
We'll just call you Jerry Springer.
Your Fitbit.
I wanted to know if plantar fasciitis is considered a workplace injury, and how would we prove that to our employer?
Good one.
Yes, it is. We have had claims accepted for plantar fasciitis and have won. The big argument that you have to make is the fact that they are on hard floor, that they are having to wear hard footwear, that they don't have a natural congenital condition like flat foot, that sort of pronation of the foot that I mentioned, that there is no gait abnormality. So normally when we deal with a compensation claim for plantar fasciitis, we'll send them for gait testing, G-A-I-T. It's a fancy word for saying how you walk. And so we'll send them to a podiatrist or a chiropodist. They'll do a gait analysis to determine how the person walks. But yes, we have had claims accepted for plantar fasciitis on that ground.
How would you go about doing that? How would a worker come to your organization?
Okay, well, maybe a good time for those not familiar with OCAL to talk a bit about who we are, what we do. I should have done that at the very beginning, I guess. I just assumed everyone knew. We offer five services, one being presentations like this on a wide variety of topics. We'll go right into your workplace. We'll deliver it to five people or something like this where we're actually delivering to 500 people across the world. We do both ergonomic and industrial hygiene assessments of workplaces. So we work with the Joint Health and Safety Committee identifying both ergonomic and hygiene problems. Hygiene not being how clean something is. Hygiene being air sampling, dust exposure, diesel exposure. So work with the committee and give recommendations on how to reduce those exposures. We also help injured workers determine the work-relatedness to compensation claims. We also have an information service. So if you want information, say, on plantar fasciitis, we would put together that information and send that to you. And we also have a strong research branch. So we work very closely with Laurentian University, as well as the Institute for Work and Health, on different research projects. Our services are free of charge. We're prepaid through your WSIB payments. So basically, you've already paid for us, you may as well use us, we're free. We have a variety of clinics across the province. So now I'm gonna get this wrong because I did it wrong on the slide. I was just informed that We're no longer by city, we're by geographic location. So Thunder Bay's northwest. What's separate?
Northeast.
I'm glad someone. Northeast. Ottawa is eastern. Toronto is central. Windsor is. How do you know all this? So Windsor's southwest. Sarnia Lambton? Southwest-west? Southwest-east? And of course, Hamilton, which is. It's Hamilton. Okay. So this is just, that's new. That has just come out in the last 2 weeks about our new names. We're no longer the Sudbury Clinic, we're the Northeastern Ontario Clinic. But we have 7 locations across the province with Eastern Ontario, headquartered out of Ottawa, I can say it that way, being our newest clinic. So we've pretty much got most of the province covered now. Okay, we have a question?
You mentioned 2 types of work boots, which you need to choose from for your body type to reduce ankle stress. What are those 2 types of boots?
I can't say because it was a specific product name. This study was actually specifically done for a mining company on which boot is better for our workers. So it was specific to the mining industry as opposed to, here's a work boot. Generically, it was a special mining mucker's boot that we were looking at. Just a little aside for when Alicia was talking about the steel toe versus the plastic composite. Both are CSA approved. They both have the green triangle on them. I actually came across the whole composite versus steel toe by accident. I went in one time, tried on the different boots, and went and started jumping up and down the middle of the store, trying it out. I was like, hey, this is really cool. So, you know, you can come across things very easily when a product works for you, once again, just by trying stuff out. Any other questions? We are running a bit ahead of schedule. We can also go beyond the presentation if you have any general ergonomic questions. We can sort of field those as best as we can as well. Oh, just wait for the mic, please. The reason we wait for the mic is people online can't hear without the microphone.
Step number 1023.
How safe is the metal compared to the composite one for the boots?
Alicia?
Well, they're both safe. It depends on what type of work you're doing. So if you're an electrician, like I mentioned, composite toe is better. I don't know. What can you say, Trevor?
Well, I think it goes through your strengths and advantages that you listed for both. That the plastic isn't 100% shatterproof.
Durability, if you want it to last longer.
Temperature. You mentioned the temperature, whether hot versus cold. So, if you're working in a hot furnace area, you know the plastic would be better. So you have to look at the advantages and disadvantages of each piece of equipment to make sure it works with your working environment. In a generalized environment, I personally would deal with the plastic just because it is a lot less weight, about half the weight of that impact happening with the ground.
And warmer for women that have cold feet.
Oh, Denny, we have another question? Denny? Just because you turned 15 today means you can't get lazy.
For workers that don't require safety footwear, but they need footwear for comfortable for walking and that sort of thing, how do you feel about running shoes or athletic shoes?
Totally. I've been in office environments where people are complaining of foot, low back, knee pain, wearing 3-inch stiletto heels. I will say, put on a comfortable pair of shoes. We're seeing a huge transition right now from seated workstations to standing workstations. Well, my first recommendation is if you're using a standing workstation, you need to be wearing comfortable shoes. You can't be standing in 3-inch stiletto heels that is still going to give you the back pain. You need to be in comfortable working shoes at all times. Any other questions at all?
Okay, well, with that being said, I'd like to thank everyone for attending this year's event again. Please remember to fill in the evaluation forms, both those here in the audience and those online. And Andy, you're raising your hand. Oh, okay, another question just came in. While we're waiting for the question to be read, please fill in the evaluation forms.
If you're working as a tractor mechanic that work with exceptionally heavy parts, would the composite be strong enough to protect the toes or foot?
To answer that question safely, I would say check with the supplier. I'm always a big one on checking the standards, the regs, the durability of the product. So to answer that offhand, I'm really not comfortable answering. I would say check the specs of the equipment before actually trying it. Okay, so please fill in the evaluations. Once again, thank you so much for coming, and we'll see you again next year. And for those in the audience, lunch is ready.